like you lost another one.
Hey, y'all. Hey. Welcome, everyone, to Saki's Speakeasy podcast, where I speak easily on various topics that cross my mind throughout the day. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me your most precious commodity, your time. You could be anywhere else right now, but you're here starting a new book in the Speakeasy with me. So welcome. Do me a favor. Show my moderators some love and affection moving in the right direction as they're running around all blue-lipped and out of breath, keeping us safe while we're reading in the Speakeasy. So love them up a little bit. Thank you so much. And while you're at it, like, share, comment, and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, making sure you click that notification bell, selecting all, so you'll be notified each time I go live. Welcome to my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to my channel. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers. I appreciate you all being here. Excuse me. So let's see who's here. Hey, Love Jones. That's my little quietly learning in the back all day super sniper. Welcome. Welcome. And I also see Kim Burr. Welcome, Love Muffin. Thank you for coming back. I appreciate you. Welcome. Welcome. And family is in the building. That's my little Irish twin super sniper. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. Hey, Tracy Cakes. Welcome, darling. Thank you for coming back. I appreciate you. And you too, learning. Welcome, welcome, darling. I appreciate you coming back. And let me see. Bikini is in the building. Welcome back, darling. I appreciate you. That's my little sneaky laugh, super sniper right there. Welcome, welcome. All right, I think I got everybody. And anybody that is in the clouds and the shrubbery, go ahead and hit that like button, okay? Thank you so much. Ah, listen. We are starting a new book. I'm excited because, child, I was told they got some things I might be excited to read about. We're reading Just As I Am. It's book two in the Invisible Life trilogy by Lynn Harris. So I'm going to start here, Just As I Am, which picks up where Invisible Life left off, introducing Harris's appealing and authentic characters to a new set of joys, conflicts, and choices. Raymond, a young Black lawyer from the South, struggles to come to terms with his sexuality and with the grim reality of AIDS. Nicole, an aspiring singer-actress, experiences frustration in both her career and in her attempts to find a genuine love relationship. Both characters share an eclectic group of friends who challenge them and the reader to look at themselves and the world around them through different eyes. By portraying Nicole's and Raymond's joys as well as their pain, Harris never ceases to remind us that life, like love, is about self-acceptance. In this vivid portrait of contemporary Black life, with all its pressures and the complications of bisexuality, AIDS, and racism, Harris confirms a faith in the power of love, love of all kinds, to thrill and to heal, which will warm the hearts of readers everywhere. Well, we gonna see. How about that? We gonna see. So this is book two. All right, in 30 seconds, we will get started. So yes, welcome everybody. Thank you so much, Bikini, for that. Yes. We gonna see if this is good. Well, as good as they told us it is. Let's hope so, child, because listen. Now, I don't know where that doggone mumbo sauce is. Child, listen. Let me try to see if I can get wings. Y'all give me 1 second. Patience is a virtue and definitely a requirement in the speakeasy. Let me see. Child, child, child. Let's see. Let me find wings and mumbo sauce. Hey. All right, let's see. There we go. I just say I'm live, boo. All right. Hopefully that'll get delivered. All right, y'all. We'll see. Okay. There are always two sides to every story. That's how it starts. Chapter one. I'm guessing this is chapter one, child, because for all I know, this may not even be chapter one. Y'all got to understand, we got all kinds of mess happening here. Let me see. Yeah, no, this ain't even chapter one, child. This is one long ass intro. It's not even chapter one. Okay, but Well, let me not call it chapter one, okay? Because guess what? No, God, that's not what we want. Child, y'all don't even realize that this ain't chapter one. Okay. I just tried to go through there. Oop. I'm just going to title it. How about this? How about that? There are always two sides to every story. Raymond Jr., I imagine the world was created beneath a canopy of silence, perfect silence. While in my own personal silence, I would create the world I dreamed of, a world full of love and absent of life's harsh realities, a world where all dreams would come true, a place called perfect. But I've come to realize that some dreams you have to give up. I live in a world that promises to protect me, but will not catch me when I fall. In this life, I have fallen many times. From these falls, I've learned many lessons, lessons involving lust, loss, love, and life. Lessons that hit as hard as an unannounced summer thunderstorm, sudden, sometimes destructive. One of my life's unexpected lessons occurred during my senior year in college. It was on the first Friday in October that my brain released a secret it had struggled to protect throughout my adolescence. I learned on that day that my sexual orientation was not a belief or choice, but a fact of my birth. And just like the color of my skin and eyes, these things could not be changed, at least not permanently. My name is Raymond Winston Tyler Jr., and I am a 32, soon to be 33-year-old second generation attorney, the son of attorney Raymond Winston Tyler and Marley Allen Tyler, an elementary school teacher and big brother to 14-year-old Kirby. I had a happy childhood, growing up deeply ensconced in the black middle class, a child of the integrated New South, born and raised in Birmingham, Alabama, a city that in the past was known more for church bombing than being the bedrock of college football. I returned home after law school and several years of successful practice in a large New York firm. About a year ago, I moved 2 hours south to Atlanta after a 2-year stint of running my pop's law firm while he followed his lifelong dream and became a member of the Alabama State Senate. Atlanta struck me as a vibrant city, a cross between country and cosmopolitan, a city where popular eateries still took personal checks, that is, with a valid driver's license, a city consumed with sports and the dream of becoming the Motown of the 90s. Atlanta was a city on the move, and even though it didn't have the flash and energy of New York City, it was more conducive to my life than Birmingham. Now, don't get me wrong, I love my family and my birthplace. I knew it was time to move on and continue my search for perfect. I was living in a trendy Buckhead condo and working for Battle, Carroll, and Myers, a black female-owned law firm specializing in entertainment and sports law. I had originally moved to Atlanta with the understanding that I would go to work for the city government, but a few days before I was to start, I received word that a hiring freeze had been put into effect. I later found out from a friend of my father that the reason for the freeze was because someone in the mayor's office wanted the position promised to me to go to an openly gay black attorney. Now, wasn't that just the shit? My Columbia Law School education and major New York firm experience didn't amount to anything, just my sexual orientation, and then only if I was willing to make it public, which I wasn't. So, with the help of my good friend Jared Stovall, I went to work for Battle, Carroll, and Myers. My position created an ironic dilemma. I was hired in part because of my love and knowledge of college sports. The firm was actively seeking college athletes about to turn professional, and it was my job to convince these young men, mostly black and from black colleges, that the firm would be looking out for their best interests. I had just entered a period in my life when I was practicing celibacy and trying very hard to put the male body out of my mind. But now I was constantly in steamy locker rooms with some of the most beautiful bodies in the world. Our firm also represented a number of rappers and singers, but Gilliam Battle, the founder and only remaining partner, handled the majority of them along with the recording executives. Though an extremely smart woman, Gilliam didn't know jack about sports, other than the fact that pro athletes made a great deal of money and didn't have the slightest idea of what to do with it. Gilliam not only assembled a top team of attorneys, but also a staff of investment counselors, speech coaches, doctors, and whatever it took to make sure our clients represented us as well as we represented them. My social life in Atlanta was in a lot of respects similar to life in Birmingham, back in the closet. Atlanta did have a visible gay community, but it was visibly white. I wasn't forced into the closet. It was just a choice I'd made out of respect for my family, especially my pops. My parents knew about and tried to accept my sexuality, but the fact that they knew didn't mean they wanted to discuss it around the dinner table or with my little brother. So like my parents, I too decided to ignore my sexuality, went back to my old straight act the minute I left New York. Talk about your safe sex. Besides, men were basically dogs. Couldn't tell the truth if their life depended on it. And now your life does depend on it. Trust me, I know. In my past, I too have been guilty of not being totally truthful, either with men or women. But men never expect honesty. Women, on the other hand, say that they want the truth, but then they act like they don't hear you when you try to tell it like it is. Sometimes, in the heat of passion, men are not the only ones who let their sex do the thinking. Currently, there is not a female in my life besides my mother and Gilliam, but there was a man, a good man. I'd met Jared Taylor Stoll in Birmingham when he'd come to run my pop's political campaign. Jared was a political consultant who had been highly recommended when pop's victory was in doubt. Jared became a member of our family, practically moving into my parents' home during the race. Jared actually convinced me to move to Atlanta by offering me a place to stay and remarking, with a devilish smile, "I want my nigga around me all the time." Wait, what? Okay. Jared was quite handsome in a rugged sort of way. His looks inspired confidence. Tall and strapping, 6'3" and 210 pounds of slightly bow-legged biscuit brown masculinity. Large bittersweet brown eyes and a smile that would have lit up the Atlanta skyline. He was as smart as he was good-looking, finishing at the top of his class at Morris Brown College and later getting an MBA at Clark Atlanta University. He was the oldest child and the only son of a devoted mother who had raised him and his two sisters alone in Southwest Atlanta. Jared never mentioned his father. I hadn't shared my sexuality with Jared, mainly because it had never come up. I hadn't determined if Jared himself was gay or straight, just as I couldn't tell if his closely cropped hair was naturally curly or mildly relaxed. Only when I felt lonely did Jared's sexuality cross my mind. Sleeping alone with just my pillows for comfort created an insatiable void in my life. Our relationship wavered between brotherly love and romantic love, though it was a romance without sex, a romance in my mind only, at least as far as I knew. I'm what you would call a romantic, a severe romantic, yet lasting romance has eluded me. I grew up believing that you really fell in love only once, and that love would last forever, like in the movies. I now know that most people consider themselves lucky if they fall in love once and have that love returned. But I wasn't even that lucky. The truth of my present situation was a love life that consisted only of daydreams about Jared and listening to R&B songs about love dreamed but never attained. I longed for a love that would make me feel like the soothing love songs that caused an involuntary smile to linger not only on my face but in my heart. A love life that was an eternal quiet storm. My love life had included a quartet of lovers, two men, Kelvin and Quinn, sandwiched between my first love, Sela, and Nicole, the woman who had broken my heart because I hadn't told the truth. A lie that sent me packing back to Birmingham, back into the closet and into my present celibate state. Now, even though I hate labels, I still consider myself bisexual. A sexual mulatto. I mean, how else could I explain how members of the singing group In Vogue, certain members of the Atlanta Braves, aroused my sexual desires with equal measure? I didn't feel comfortable in a totally gay environment or in a totally straight environment. I often wondered where the term gay came from. Lonely would better describe the life for me. There was absolutely nothing gay about being a black man and living life attracted to members of your own sex in this imperfect world I called home. For now, a place called perfect remained a dream. Okay, And that's the end of his section. All right. Y'all listen. I don't even know. I guess I could just leave these two sandwiched together. Because there's also another child, it don't even tell you where you at. What the hell? What? All right. I'm gonna do this like this. Because it really doesn't give you the option of anything else. All right, so what are y'all thinking so far? We're kind of getting a recap of something, I guess. Y'all listen. Nicole, when I was in the fourth grade, the boy who sat behind me would always pull my hair anytime he thought no one was looking. He would really get on my nerves. One day, instead of pulling my braids, he slipped a note in my hand. It read, "Will you go with me? Yes, no, maybe. Please circle one." Since I didn't know where he wanted me to go, I placed the note in my knee socks and took it home to my daddy, asking him what I should do. He gave me some advice I've always tried to live by. "Listen to your heart," he said. From my daddy's words of wisdom, I realized that my heart has a voice. It speaks to me with each beat. My heart protects me, shielding me from the things I can't see or lack the courage to face. My heart knows who I am and who I'll turn out to be. My name is Nicole Marie Springer, former beauty queen, Broadway actress, sometime word processor. 30 years of age, but that's 25 in showbiz years. Born and raised in Sweet Home, Arkansas, right outside of Little Rock, population 585 and one stoplight. Daughter of cotton farmers James and Idella Springer, older sister of Michael A. No, older sister of Michael, sorry. A small town girl with big city goals. They say in every life, some rain must fall. But I've just come through a couple of years of domination by thunderstorms. Right now, my life is cloudy and overcast, anxiously awaiting the sun. In the last 3 years, I lost my beloved father to a sudden heart attack. My best friend, Candace, to AIDS, and Raymond, the brief love of my life, to another man. The death of my daddy, though sudden, was not quite a surprise. He was 77 years old and had spent his twilight years defying his doctor by not taking his high blood pressure medication. But the loss of my college sorority sister and closest confidant was devastating. Candace, the first person I had met at Spelman College, was not only beautiful and brilliant, but was just months away from her dream of becoming a physician. Her sudden illness hit like a ton of bricks. Candace, who told me hours after our initial meeting that she was going to become a doctor, marry, and have two children. She lived to see only one of those dreams come true, marrying Kelvin on her deathbed. Kelvin Ellis, the suspected culprit of Candace's demise. Kelvin, the same man who introduced me to Raymond, who I fell quickly and deeply in love with, the love I thought my heart had led me to. I never found out if Kelvin was in fact the man in Raymond's secret life. I was too distraught to even think about it. After the breakup with Raymond, I began to doubt my own sexuality. Had I not been enough woman to satisfy him, or had I been too much? I spent night after night crying myself to sleep, praying that my daddy and Candace would send down some advice, since I could no longer count on my heart. I questioned how Candace and I could have fallen in love with men who were so incapable of loving us completely. Men who would never give the one thing they could give for free. Honesty. My relationship with Raymond did slap me into reality. I realized that things were not always what they seemed. I now questioned any man I was interested in dating, asking if he was gay or bisexual, or if he planned either in the future. This chick is insane. Hey, Choco Chips. Welcome back, Love Muffin, and thank you for bringing the good vibes with you. I appreciate you, darling. Though I couldn't always detect the truth, I got a lot of interesting responses, including one guy who threw wine in my face and then stormed out of the restaurant we were in. The wine tasted like a yes to me. There was also the guy who, when I posed the question to him, politely excused himself from the dinner table, went into his bedroom, and returned minutes later, standing before me, butterball, butt naked, with a certain part of his anatomy at attention. Does this answer your question? He smiled. I wanted to respond with a song I loved. Is that all there is? But I know how men are about their, well, you know. These dates from hell led me to my current beau, Dr. Pierce Gessler. In a decade where everybody was looking for safe sex, I was searching for safe love. With Pierce, I was able to maintain my self-imposed celibacy vow and still have a suitable escort when needed. Oh yes, Pierce is white and Jewish. So much for my dreams of marrying a BMW, black man working, or a BMS, black man straight. But Pierce was wonderful, supportive, and loving without a lot of luggage. She just don't know. Those are the most likely to be bisexual, you know. A white man working, a white man professional, a white man pretending to be straight. Chaba. He helped me out in the lean times when I was getting more calls from temp agencies than my agent. An agent whom I later fired when I heard him tell a casting person at a soap opera that I was a dark-skinned Robin Givens. Pierce was always telling me how beautiful I was. It made me feel good. No man besides my daddy had ever constantly told me I was beautiful. Raymond told me a couple of times, but his honesty was in question. And even though I had won several beauty pageants and was third runner-up to Miss America, I never considered myself beautiful. When I looked in the mirror, I saw a face enhanced by fashion fair makeup. I used to wear that makeup back in the day. And hair, even though it was my own, permed with the help of a colorful box of chemicals. In addition to Pierce, I was also blessed with two wonderful friends, Delaney and Kyle. I first met Delaney at an audition, and again later when she was doing hair and makeup for a show I was appearing in, my big Broadway starring role that closed after 31 performances. Delaney was very beautiful, a talented dancer, and I think they mean and just a little bit crazy. I don't know why they put an A in the middle of that. She made me smile and take a look at life from a more upbeat view. Kyle, Raymond's best friend, had become a friend through default, and in a selfish way, our friendship allowed me to keep in contact with Raymond without really being in contact. Sneaky bitch. I don't like that type of shit. Don't become his best friend's friend just so you can keep up with him, hoe. Pick up the fucking phone and call him, stupid. He wrote you a letter in the last book and asked to ask, tell him what's up. Anyway, Kyle was handsome in a cute little boy sort of way. Cornbread brown skin, deep-set brown eyes, thin black curly hair that was starting to recede. Oh, don't tell me his top is dropping. And a smile that could dilute darkness. Kyle was openly gay and didn't pull any punches. You knew where he stood. I could deal with that. He was my first openly gay friend, and he kept me in stitches with his quick wit. My career in New York, similar to my love life, had been one of highs and lows. Moments when I didn't feel very successful, times when I would have given anything to be sitting on the porch back home watching my dad eating sardines and crackers while I munched on strawberry now and laters. Oh, man. Okay. After signing with another agent, I was constantly being told that I was talented, but they were looking for a different type. But I wasn't going to complain because I was back on Broadway, waiting in the wings again as the understudy for the female lead in Jelly's Last Gem. I've been in the show for 6 months, but I've never gone on. Renee Kelly, the lady I'm understudying, once commented in her Chatty Cathy doll fashion, I think it's so unprofessional to miss a performance at any time. I mean, these poor people pay their hard-earned money to see me. I took this to mean, don't even think about going on, Miss Thang. Not now, not ever. So in this life that offered more rainstorms than rainbows, I relied on my faith, my trio of friends, and a great therapist. I was learning to count and enjoy my blessings. I realized that luck ran out, but blessings never did. Facts. I was constantly employed on stage or in a steno pool. I had my name on a lease in a rent-controlled building and a little money in the bank. And even though Pierce was not the man I dreamed of as a little girl, he treated me like royalty. The choice I had to make was whether or not I wanted to wear this crown. For now, my response was similar to that note from the first suitor of my youth. Like then, I think I'll circle, maybe. All right. Okay. So I think, oh, that's the end of that section. Okay. Child, listen. You get all these, this thing is like a whole mess here. Like, I don't really, let's see. I don't think they really tell you anything here. Let me see. I'm trying to, it's not telling me how long this is gonna last. Wait a minute. Okay. Part one, lust. Lust the one you're with. Child, listen. And then you get chapter one. Okay. A mess. I can't with the way this book is set up. Okay. Child, listen. This is a mess. Okay, chapter one. The ringing phone seemed to shake the darkened hotel room. I quickly reached for the phone, knocking over a glass and sending my watch to the floor. Good morning, Mr. Tyler. This is your 8:30 a.m. wake-up call. Thank you for staying at the Capitol Hill Hyatt Regency. Have a great day, the computerized voice said. I noticed a shaft of light coming through the thick curtains as I pulled myself up from the bed and headed toward the bathroom. Hey, Marva. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Give me 1 second. Let's see. Because I believe in helping people out a little bit. You just sit there and watch. But you don't know how to act. Okay. I picked up the green folder that included the charges for our 3-day stay. Reading material for the plane, I thought. I relieved myself and stumbled back into the still dim room. Kyle, I whispered. Yeah, Kyle mumbled. You up? What do you think? Well, I'll take my shower first. What time does your train leave? 10:30. What time is it? 8:30. I returned to the small bathroom, started the shower, and turned on the hot water in the sink. I rummaged through my shaving bag to locate my razor and toothbrush. The large mirror forced a glimpse of my red eyes and the haggard look on my face. Boy, what a weekend. I couldn't believe it was over. When I got back to Atlanta, the first thing I was going to do was sleep. For days, Kyle and I were in Washington, D.C. for the annual Memorial Day weekend when thousands upon thousands of black gay men convened in the nation's capital in sort of a silent fraternity convention. The parties had been nonstop meeting and greeting. During the day, there were brunches and in the evening, barbecues and numerous house parties. The Sunday preceding Memorial Day, the attendees had waited hours just to get inside a packed bar called Rails, a massive warehouse located near the Navy Yard that could not accommodate the men who had simply taken over the city. Kyle went to Rails and said it took him 3 hours to get in, but it was worth the wait. I opted for a more elegant affair given by a group called the Men. Ooh, sounds upper crust. I told Kyle, I'm going to a party where the men may be a little older, but the majority of them are homeowners and not simply owners of Metro cards. Since I didn't go to gay bars in Atlanta, this weekend played an important part in my social life. It was exciting seeing so many good-looking black men in one place. The only sad part was that the 3-day holiday was so short, and since I was not engaging in sex, I could only look and lust. Still, I met some interesting men. One in particular, an attractive sports lawyer from Philadelphia named Errol, who, when I repeated his name, replied, "Yes, Errol, like in Flynn." Errol was interesting, but we both faced the "you're too nice for me" syndrome, a common syndrome in the Black gay community where nice, good-looking, educated Black gay or bisexual men didn't mind being friendly, but would never date each other. The funny thing was most men would say they didn't like the syndrome, but no one did anything about it. Some traditions were hard to break, thus making it difficult to establish long-lasting relationships that weren't based on sex and penis size. Black women thought they had it tough finding a suitable mate. I quickly showered and threw my clothes into my leather garment bag. I had taken great pains packing for the trip, and now all my clothes were wrinkled and stained and smelled of my various colognes. My flight to Atlanta was due to leave at 9:45, so I was cutting things close. "Well, buddy, I'm out of here. I'll call you later tonight when I get home," I said. "Have a safe flight, baby. It's been fun." "Real fun," Kyle said as he positioned himself on the edge of the bed. "Yeah, it has been fun. I don't know why we do this to each other." "Yeah, me either. You get on out of here before I get emotional. I'll see you the next time you're in the city. Now, seriously, think about meeting me in L.A. for the 4th of July weekend. I'm sorry." "I will. Hey, you know I love you. Have a safe trip home. Tell Nicole I send my best. And to get rid of that white boy," I joked as I gave Kyle a hug. "I'll make sure I tell her just that," he responded. As I headed out the door, I heard Kyle call my name again. "Ray." "Yeah, Kyle. Tell Jared." I nodded in wordless agreement and then moved quickly down the hotel hallway to the elevator and rushed through the lobby. The doorman, whose face I had grown accustomed to during the weekend, gave me a broad smile and signaled a taxi as I came through the automatic door. "Have a safe trip. Come back and see us again," he instructed. "Thanks, I will," I replied and firmly placed two crumpled dollar bills into his large hands. As he slammed the door to the taxi, he leaned through the front window and told the driver, "National Airport." As the taxi sped away from the hotel and down 14th Street, I enjoyed one last glimpse of the nation's capital. It had been a great weekend, but I was excited about my return home. I hoped Jerry would be waiting at the gate when my flight arrived. Knowing him, I was sure he'd be right there. We arrived at the busy National Airport, and after paying the taxi driver, I stopped briefly to enjoy the honey sweet morning air. It was a clear day. The sky was a cloudless, piercing blue, and I perceived that spring was making its retreat as summer approached. At the gate, I detected trouble. The line was nearly a mile long. At least it looked like a mile. I checked the monitors and saw that my flight was now leaving almost an hour behind schedule. I overheard people in line talking about weather problems in Cincinnati. I thought about Jared and hoped he'd call the airline before heading out. While I pondered my next move, my eyes began to travel around to the various news and food stands, but I decided to get my shoes shined instead. That's right, I love a man in some good-looking shoes. Anyway, there were a lot of familiar faces roaming around the airport from the weekend. The place had the look of a large meeting of African-American men, but the majority of these men were members of the silent frat. There were three chairs at the shoe shine stand. Two elderly Black men were shining the shoes of customers as though it was their last shine, and one young, attractive Black female was just finishing up a client. She looked my way, gently tapped her empty chair. I quickly jumped into the well-worn chair, and she began rolling up the legs of my Black linen pants with one hand and offered me a copy of The Washington Post with the other. "Where you going?" she inquired. "Atlanta." "Atlanta? That's where you from?" "Yes, that's where I'm from. Well, I'm sorry, that's where I'm living for the time being." "How do you like it?" she questioned. "Oh, I love Atlanta. A great city," I said with pride. "I heard there are a lot of jobs down there with the Olympics and all," she commented. "Well, it's a little bit better than the rest of the country, but the jobs are still pretty scarce. I heard there are a lot of good-looking men down there. I mean, with all the colleges and stuff." "Well, I wouldn't know about that," I lied, suppressing a smile. Of course, Atlanta was full of good-looking Black men. "I know this. If you're an example of how the men look, then I'm getting my ass in that bag of yours," she joked with a girlish giggle. "Now stop teasing me," I laughed. We were both enjoying the exchange when suddenly her laughter stopped. While busy shining my shoes, she spotted an attractive, well-built Black man who, from his outward mannerisms, led you to believe he was gay. Actually, I knew he was gay since I had seen him at one of the weekend parties. He noticed my gaze and gave me a broad smile, revealing beautiful teeth, and I returned a polite, chilly nod. "You know that's a damn shame," the shine lady muttered. "What a motherfucking shame. Here he is, all that man, and he wants to be with a woman. You know, I don't understand why all our brothers got to be sissies. I guess that's some more shit the white man has laid on our brothers. If they ain't in jail, then they're punks." By now, I had turned my eyes back to the newspaper, not looking at her or the guy under attack. I just wanted her to finish so that I could get down and head to my gate. "What do you think about that?" she asked, interrupting my thoughts. "Excuse me?" I asked, with concealed resentment. "How do you feel about all these black sissies? It seems like a whole army of them have invaded the district this weekend. Just a damn shame. A damn shame," she repeated. This lady was burning. Her cheerful face of moments ago was now painted with a sour look. I could envision smoke coming from her ears as she rolled down my pant legs and tapped the toe of my shoes. She gazed around the airport with a laser stare and the expertise of an air traffic controller about to direct the landing of a troubled plane. She didn't look in my direction until I placed a $5 bill in her hand. "Keep the change," I suggested dryly. "Thank you, sir. You have a safe flight now," she said in a preoccupied tone. I grabbed my bags and started toward my gate. About 5 steps into my walk, I turned and for a moment became frozen like a frame in a comic strip. The hatred in her face and voice bothered me deeply. The fact that she was black made my feelings more intense. I released myself from a freeze frame and slowly reapproached the shine stand and the angry young lady. "Miss," I called out. "You back already?" she grinned. "You know, you should really be careful what you say. You never know who you're talking to," I said. She gave me a puzzled look, obviously unaware of what my statement meant. I walked away feeling a little bit better about myself, but still saddened by her outburst. I didn't look back at her, nor did she respond verbally as I walked at an accelerated pace toward the gate. Now I was ready to go home. The large leather plane seat provided a warm sanctuary from which to think and map out a game plan. A friendly ticket agent had upgraded my economy seat to first class. My smile never failed me. The upgrade was a welcome relief because I could see that coach was packed with what could only be former Greyhound bus frequent travelers. I thought of Kyle's parting words that I must tell Jared how I truly felt about him and my sexuality. For the most part, I thought Kyle, as usual, was right, but a remote fear kept doubts lingering. What if Jared responded the way the lady in the airport had to black gay men? No, he wouldn't do that. But what would happen to our now near-perfect relationship? If Jared was in fact gay and was simply uncertain about me, then it could be the start of a truly perfect relationship. But if he wasn't gay and he distanced himself from me, how I would mourn the loss of his friendship. And if what goes around comes around, then I was due for payback because of all the pain I brought on Nicole and Quinn. The last time I was truthful with someone I loved about my sexuality, the relationship ended abruptly. I waited so long because I strongly believe the best romantic relationships were those solidly based on friendship. I didn't, however, believe that every special friendship would turn romantic. Kyle and I had been friends for over a decade, and there had never been a trace of romance. Yes, he was very smart and attractive and one of the most self-assured black men, gay or straight, I had ever met. He was gay. Make no bones about it. He relished being gay, the lifestyle, and enjoyed everything it had to offer. Kyle had overcome alcohol and drug abuse and was now the owner of a small but successful costume design and fashion firm. Picture this. It was great seeing him enjoy the weekend of parties without drinking or doing drugs. I was not certain, however, if he had conquered his addiction for strong, well-built, and of course, well-hung black men, but I was still quite proud of him. Kyle was one of the reasons that I miss New York. We still talked almost every day on the phone, but it wasn't like the old days when he would phone and minutes later, we would be on the subway headed toward the village or catching a taxi to the now closed Nickel Bar. What? The Nickel Bar closed? I hate to hear that. Listen, like it was someplace I had really been. But I hate to hear that the Nickel Bar closed. Kyle felt strongly that honesty was the best policy when it came to Jared. A few years back, he hadn't felt that way when I was dating Nicole and decided to come clean with her. He'd felt that what she didn't know wouldn't hurt her. I guess that proved that even the gayest of men could still be chauvinistic in their attitudes about females and the truth. In the case of Nicole, Kyle had been right. My being truthful cost me a chance at happiness, but how long would that happiness have lasted before my sexuality would have caused her more pain than my early admission? Let me stop right here. If what he had promised her were true, remember when he said, "Oh, I can just, not be with men or whatever have you." If he had kept his word about that, then quite surely, quite naturally, it would never have come up and would never have been an issue, right? Remember that? Remember he said that. That's what he said. So I'm trying to think, like, how could he possibly think that it would be an issue? I don't know, y'all. Maybe I'm confusion. Is that what I am? Am I confusion? I'm trying to think out if I'm confusion. Okay, anyway, maybe my timing had a lot to do with it. I did reveal myself to her during a very difficult period in a hospital just doors away from her dying best friend, and shortly after we'd made love for the first time without protection. I decided I had to tell her at that exact moment rather than risk the chance that somebody else might tell her to protect himself, the somebody being my first male lover, Kelvin, husband to Nicole's best friend, Candace. I still secretly hoped that one day, Nicole and I would sit down and talk face to face about our relationship, what future, if any, we had. I wanted the chance to explain my life in more detail so she would understand that it wasn't something she did or something I planned. I believed very strongly that my chances for a long-term relationship were greater with a woman than with a man, but I thought Nicole deserved something better, and maybe Jared offered me something I hadn't dreamed possible. He was, like Nicole, one of the most extraordinary human beings I had ever met. Jared's infectious smile was a welcome sight. He was all decked out in a crayon, wait a minute, a crayon red polo shirt, tight and outlining the muscled contours of his chest. I could see this despite the fact that he was wearing a cotton t-shirt under the polo. Jared was one of those guys who always wore a t-shirt no matter what, an undershirt that I was certain was tucked tightly into his jockey underwear. It could be the dead of summer, and there was always that t-shirt and Jared looking cool, calm, and collected. The t-shirt and Jared's smile caused a big grin to break out across my face. "What up?" Jared asked as he gave me a big bear hug. "You the man," I replied. "How was the trip? Did you miss me?" "Of course you missed me," Jared asked and answered confidently. "Didn't think about you one second," I teased. "Yeah, right. Cool. So, did your business go as planned?" "Business? Oh, yeah. Business was great," I quickly recovered. Jared and I stood by the steel gray carousels, just looking and grinning at each other as assorted luggage rolled by. In this enormous airport, it seemed as though we were the only ones there. There was an unnatural stillness surrounding us, the two of us acting very bashful. "How much luggage did you take?" Jared asked, breaking the silence. "Luggage?" I quizzed, suddenly realizing that all my luggage was on my shoulders. "Oh shit," I laughed. "I forgot I didn't check my luggage. Nigga, please. What are we standing up here looking stupid for? Let's drive," Jared said. Yo, they have stood up there the whole damn time, and this fool ain't even got no luggage. I know you lying. Hang on, y'all. Give me one second. Okay. I'll just be trying to help people out, y'all, because they be needing it. Okay. All right. Sorry. Whose car did you drive? Yours, of course. It's much nicer, and the females notice me more when I drive it, Jared observed. I didn't respond as I walked side by side with Jared through the airport, out the sliding glass doors, and toward the parking lot. Jared picked up the pace, allowing me to catch a glimpse of his backside and clinging white jeans. His rapid steps made it clear that he wanted to get to the car before me. I thought about Jared's comments regarding women and my car. Yes, I had to admit that my royal blue BMW 535 attracted a certain amount of female and male attention. But did Jared say female to throw me off, or was that The real deal. Why does he have access to your car if y'all ain't fucking and sucking? Because I'm sorry. My homie ain't driving my car. I don't give a damn how long we've been homies. It wasn't that Jared had never mentioned females before. He had a great admiration for the female form, but so did I. He never spoke of women in a derogatory fashion or by body parts. Jared was always very respectful as though he were speaking of his mother. I appreciated that. I'd spent enough time to last a lifetime with men who always referred to women by names usually reserved for female dogs. Oh, he talking about bitches. Okay, gotcha. As we approached my car, I could tell that it had been waxed. I mean, the car was shining so brightly that I could see my reflection even while I was several feet away from the door. I couldn't recall the last time the car looked so good, with the exception of the day I purchased it. Jared, what did you do to my car? I asked. What do you think I did? I gave it the cleaning it so desperately needed. Oh, shit, man, it looks great. Thanks a million. No problem. Get in. Since I cleaned it, I'm gonna drive it. You don't have to say it twice, I said as I reached for the door handle on the passenger side. Just as I was preparing to sit down, I saw a little gift box neatly wrapped. Two plastic champagne glasses were lying over the glove compartment. What's this? I asked, trying to conceal my smile. Welcome back, my nigga. Jared smiled. Man, you're something else. Go ahead, open the box. I threw my luggage in the back seat, quickly snapped my seatbelt on, and started to rip open the small box. Moments later, I saw there was nothing but tissue paper in the box, and I looked over at Jared, who was picking up speed to enter the freeway heading toward downtown Atlanta. There's nothing in here, Jared, I said. Hold up. Look under the seat first. I felt under the seat and, with my slight touch, out rolled a bottle of Cristal champagne. Open it. Let's celebrate you getting back safe and the end of the holiday. Okay. But what about the box? Wasn't something supposed to be in there? I asked greedily. Yes, I got tickets to the Braves game tonight, but I didn't pick them up. They're at the will call window. That's the second part of the surprise. Jared, that's the shit. You know this will be my first Braves game. In fact, this will be my first professional baseball game ever. I know that. Pops told me. But my birthday is weeks away. How are you going to top this? Don't worry about it. Just pop the cork and let's do this. I quickly popped the cork of the champagne bottle. I was as excited as a kid going on his first Ferris wheel ride at the fair. The Braves were the hottest thing in Atlanta. Only Braves tickets were hotter. I love all sports, but only started to appreciate baseball after moving to Atlanta. It was impossible to live in Atlanta and not get caught up with the Braves, and here I was going to a game. I balanced the plastic glasses and slowly poured the golden colored beverage. Maybe you shouldn't drink and drive, I said in a protective tone. I know, but just a tiny sip to celebrate. We can finish it at your place before the game. Cool, I responded. Well, what the fuck is the difference? I responded. I inhaled the champagne's sweet aroma and began to sip it slowly, rolling it in my mouth and letting it glide over the surface of my tongue and then down my throat. I couldn't ever remember champagne tasting so wonderful and exhilarating. I smiled at the fact that Jared had called my father Pops. Jared, with a warm gleam in his eyes, sped down Highway 85 North as I relaxed and observed Atlanta's phallic skyline and enjoyed my pleasant laziness. I began to hum along with Vanessa Williams' Save the Best for Last as the song blasted over the car stereo. Atlanta was enjoying a bright, warm day, and the air seemed startlingly clear and pure. I rolled down the window so that I could smell the brisk air and continue to savor the moment. That's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Okay. Here we go. Let me see. All right. Hold on, y'all. Okay. Okay, let's get ready for this next chapter. Can I get a little warmth on this, sir? Thank you. As y'all can see, my butler still works for me. He needs that 75 cents an hour. Chapter 2. Seconds after I first opened my eyes in the morning, the phone rang. I quickly grabbed it before the answering machine came on. Praise the Lord, Nicole, girl. Sheila exclaimed. Praise him, Sheila, I replied. How you doing? Sheila asked. I'm blessed. How about you? I'm blessed too, girl. Let's get started. Okay, you got anything special you want to pray for today? No, not really. I have an audition later on this afternoon, but I'm not that excited about it. What about you? No, nothing special. Let's just thank him and send one up for those who need it. Okay, why don't you start? Sheila's voice went from its light tone into a very serious and reverent pitch. As she prayed over the telephone line, I stood and pulled myself up from a queen-size bed and reached for my lilac robe. I closed my eyes and felt a slight chill over my body from Sheila's words as she rapidly thanked Christ for the many blessings he had granted. I thought about all the things I wanted to say when it was my turn to pray over the phone lines. Sheila and I had been prayer partners for about 2 years. There were only a few days since we'd started praying that we'd missed. I met Sheila in the SAG, Screen Actors Guild, office one day when she was posting a notice for a prayer partner. I had no idea what a prayer partner was, but I was going through a difficult time, and when she explained it to me, I was instantly sold. Nicole, yes? What do you want to thank the Lord for? Without responding, I went into prayer, thanking Christ for waking me up and thanking him for the positive day I was about to have. A few minutes into the prayer, I forgot that I was standing in my bedroom in my nightgown and robe. I felt as though I was in church. Sheila responded regularly with, yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you. As I brought my prayer to a close, I opened my eyes and glanced out my bedroom window. A light rain was falling. Wrap yourself up, girl. It's raining. Cats and dogs out there, Sheila instructed with the tone of a mother. I will. You have a blessed day, I responded. I will. I'll talk with you in the morning. As important as Sheila was in my life, we hardly saw each other. She was married and lived in Brooklyn with her husband and little boy. We went to different churches, but it was hard to imagine my life without her, despite her tendency to be quite self-righteous at times. I went into the kitchen of my small one-bedroom apartment and put up the kettle for my morning tea. I walked back into my bedroom and watched the rain run down the window of my Upper East Side apartment. Outside, Manhattan rushed, bumped, and shoved toward a new day. I saw taxis splashing through the street and listened to horns blaring loudly with impatience. I pressed my nose against the condensation-covered window and watched people scurrying along the sidewalks under umbrellas, women in soaked tennis shoes, men with damp folded newspapers and briefcases bravely facing the rain bareheaded. The pace and energy of the city were that of the previous, sun-soaked day. All right. The phone and the tea kettle seemed to shriek at the same time. I rushed back into the kitchen, grabbed my cordless phone, and clicked it on. Hello? Hey, girl. Delaney, what's going on, girl? You know, the same old, same old. What time are you leaving your apartment? In about 30 minutes. Are you going on that audition? What audition? I quiz. You know, the douche commercial. I understand it's a national. I just know my agent isn't sending me on a douche commercial. You better work Grand Broadway, diva. I'm scared of you. It must be nice to be able to pass up shit, Delaney laughed. No, girl, you know what I mean. Is this one of those commercials where they're going to shoot two? One with a white girl and the other one with one of us? You know, I don't know, and I don't give a damn. Well, I think I'm going to pass. Sam probably didn't send me up for it. I've got to read a sitcom script he sent over. That's cool. Oh, I'm sorry. That's cool with me. Less competition. Lord knows I ain't got no problem with people knowing that my pussy is fresh and clean. Delaney giggled. Girl, you crazy. And hopefully about $20,000 richer when I get this commercial. Good luck. Call me when you get back. I will, darling. Talk to you. Oh, Delaney. Yeah? What about step class? I'll be there. I'll see you there if I don't hear from you. Okay, girl. See ya. My hot water was now lukewarm. I placed the tea bag into my favorite pink coffee mug and popped it into the microwave. I started the shower and thought about my conversation with Delaney. Who did I think I was passing up a who did I think I was, passing up a shot at a national commercial, and why hadn't Sam told me about it? I mean, I was constantly getting on her about sending me out on more commercial calls. Lord knows, years ago, I would have jumped at the chance at any product. Wasn't as though I would be competing against Delaney. We had completely different looks, and the casting agents probably already knew what look they were going for. I lost track and didn't know if this was the dark-skinned Naomi Campbell look or the light-skinned Troy Bayer look. Weak. If Sam called at the last minute and insisted I go on this audition, that would clue me in that they were looking for my type. With the rain still coming down, I would have to contend with my hair. The hot tea and a hot shower sounded so much better. Besides, I didn't feel like rejection so early in the week. After my shower, I pulled my hair up, rolled it into a ball, and curled up on my sofa, teacup and script in hand. I smiled at the thought of Delaney telling the casting agent that she didn't care if the world knew her stuff was clean and fresh. They would hire her on the spot. That is, if the casting agent had a sense of humor. A realistic question in my business. It was great having a close friend in the business whom I didn't feel I had to compete with. Delaney was very talented, but she had a different niche from me. She was constantly being booked for rap and R&B videos and often referred to herself as a video hoe. I guess that's their way of telling us that she had big titties, a small waist, and a fat ass. All right, anyway, sorry. She was an excellent dancer, basically trained or classically trained, and an expert with hip-hop steps, a dance style I never was able to learn. She left the Dance Theater of Harlem over a year ago when cutbacks had forced them to cut out a major part of their season. Since Delaney couldn't depend on commercials and videos, she, like me, knew the major word processing packages just in case. She was also an excellent makeup artist and had worked as a dresser in several Broadway shows. Her brownish-yellow skin tone, rail-thin body with a black girl's behind, and short curly haircut made her a favorite among video casting agents and rap artists. The ironic thing was Delaney held a strong aversion to rap music, and the men who sang it said they treated women like crap, although that wasn't the word she used. Delaney had a colorful vocabulary. Sounds like my kind of chick. She was more at home with Diane Reeves, Patti LaBelle, or Patti Austin, but those divas rarely used women as attractive as Delaney in their videos. Aside from the both of us being in the business, Delaney and I had little else in common. That is, if you overlook the fact that we couldn't live without each other. Delaney was from the greater Northwest, having been raised in Seattle before moving to New York at 18 to study at Juilliard and later to dance full-time with DTH. She said she wasn't college material and deplored beauty pageants with the same antipathy she felt for rap music. Faith wasn't high on her list of priorities, and she constantly kidded me about my morning prayer calls with Sheila. Delaney once said, "Many people attend church, but very few understand." Made a lot of sense when you thought about it. She didn't appear to be preoccupied with getting married either. She had dated several guys, but none of the relationships seemed serious. Maybe the wanting to be married was a Southern girl trait. When I advised her to make sure she asked them the gay questions and their HIV status, she instructed me to lighten up. That nigga Raymond, or whatever his name was, really fucked you up. Not every good-looking black man is a sissy. The use of words like sissy made me wonder if Delaney was homophobic, but then I would think about how tight she and Kyle were and dismiss the thought. But then again, everybody loved Kyle. Also, some of the guys she hung out with from the shows were definitely gay, but she had a point. I needed to lighten up. I couldn't let my failed relationship with Raymond shape the rest of my love life, something I was working on with the help of Dr. Huntley. I realized I had mixed feelings when it came to gay men, especially black gay men. I'd started seeing Dr. Vanessa Huntley shortly after Candace died. The first year we worked on my grief about Candace's death, but then slowly turned to my relationships with men, my shaky relationship with my mother, and my own lack of self-confidence. Initially, I saw Dr. Huntley twice a week, but I had recently cut back to once a week. I hadn't told anyone I was seeing a psychiatrist. It was the one secret I kept to myself. My daddy used to always tell me to keep a secret for myself. It wasn't that I was embarrassed about seeing a doctor. Anyone could understand the need for professional help after what I had been through, but I felt needing professional care said something about my religious beliefs. I've been taught and for the most part believed that prayer and faith could solve any problems I face. Girl, go to hell. You don't even know what the problems are that you face. That's why you need a doctor to at least help you uncover them. And then you can pray and ask the good Lord to help your black ass fix them. I'm sorry. I lost myself for a moment. Anyway. But in the early weeks following Candace's death and my breakup with Raymond, I felt I needed to talk to someone I could see. The rain had stopped and the sun drenched the city when I finally finished the silly sitcom script. I glanced at the mute television and realized from the soap opera on the screen that it was close to 3 o'clock. I had less than an hour to get over to the West Side for step class, my appointment, and dinner before heading to the theater and another night of wishing that Renee wouldn't show up and I'd finally get the chance to once again do what I loved and was being paid to do. I debated on my mode of transportation and decided to catch a taxi since I was wearing my workout clothes. I placed a change of clothes in a garment bag and headed downstairs. Even though I taxied to the health spa on 76th and Broadway, Delaney had gotten there before me and was right in the front row. She saw me come in and signaled me to join her up front. I hesitated because I didn't want anyone tripping. I guess Delaney could sense my reservation, so she yelled, "Nicole, come on up. I saved this spot for you." Oh. I meekly moved from the back of the crowded gym to the front, trying not to notice the stares and looks as I got closer to Delaney. Excuse me, I said as I moved through the crowd. Girl, why are you moving so slow? These children ain't hardly paying you no mind. Besides, all my good girlfriends are up here. Before I could respond, the music started, and the only sounds besides the blasting pop music were the slapping of hands and thighs and heavy breathing. Minutes later, sweat was popping from every pore of my body, but I was beginning to feel good. After a quick shower, Delaney and I bounced out of the club and onto busy Broadway. Where do you want to eat? I asked Delaney. Eat? Yes, I've got some time before I'm due at the theater. Let's do Chinese, I said, momentarily forgetting my appointment. Nick, I'm going to the Broadway Dance Center. They have a guest instructor teaching a master's tap class, and I can't miss that. A tap class? After that workout? Are you crazy? I asked as I silently breathed a sigh of relief. I didn't have time for a sit-down dinner. Child, you never know when they bring another one of those colored tap shows back to Broadway. A diva must be prepared. What are you going to do after that? I'm supposed to hook up with Kyle. He's due back from D.C. this afternoon. You know he'll have plenty of stories, Delaney laughed. Why don't you two come by the theater, I suggested. Okay, we'll see. Maybe you can come by my place or meet us up at Kyle's. Not at Kyle's, I interjected quickly. Oh yeah, I forgot. Your ban on that apartment. Child, you really need to get professional help, Delaney chided. Delaney, don't tease me. Kyle understands. I'm sure Kyle has changed that apartment so much that you wouldn't recognize it. You think so? Nicole, come on now. I don't have time to discuss this craziness. I've got to run. How are you getting down there? I'm walking. Gotta keep the blood pumping. Okay, girl, see you later, I said as I kissed Delaney on her lightly made-up cheek. As she started down Broadway, I called out, Delaney, how did the audition go? It didn't, she yelled back. They were looking for high yeller with long hair, and I ain't buying no hair this week, she laughed as she walked swiftly down Broadway. Next time, girl, next time, I murmured to myself. As Delaney vanished into the crowded street, I hailed a taxi heading uptown to my secret meeting place. The black wrought iron security gate leading to Dr. Huntley's office was slightly ajar. I rang the loud buzzer, and Dr. Huntley greeted me seconds later. Good afternoon, Nicole, come in, Dr. Huntley said as she led me into her office located in the basement of her fashionable brownstone on Harlem's famed Stryver's Row. Hi, Dr. Huntley, how are you doing today? I'm doing fine, she smiled. I walked into the dimly lit dark paneled room and took my regular position, sitting upright on a large black leather sofa. Dr. Huntley moved behind her cluttered glass top desk and sat in the oil-colored recliner. Dr. Vanessa G. Huntley was a regal brown-skinned woman, plump, broad-faced, serene, with sleepy brown eyes and short, gray-black hair. She was wearing dangling earrings that were bigger than the island of Manhattan. Pretty earrings, but big. Dr. Huntley gave me a smile as she arranged herself in the chair. Her grandmotherly smile was soft and reassuring. Is there anything you want to discuss today? It's been a couple of weeks since I've seen you, Dr. Huntley said. No, not really. Delaney was joking with me moments ago that I needed to seek professional help because I won't go up to Kyle's apartment. Refresh my memory, Nicole. Why won't you go to Kyle's apartment? Well, that's where Raymond used to live, the place where I risked my life. How so? Oh, don't you remember? I made love with him without using a condom. I felt he betrayed me because he went ahead without telling me he was bisexual. Did he force you? Oh, no, but you still blame him. Why are we discussing this? We've been over this countless times. I know I have to take some of the responsibility. He did look for a condom, but I don't want to talk about that, I said. Lifting my voice slightly, there is still some anger there, Nicole. I think we need to talk about it. Well, I'm ready to go to the apartment. I've gotten over it. I've forgiven myself and I've forgiven Raymond. Are you sure? Yes. You still sound upset. What's bothering you? I got fired from a recording session. What happened? I don't know. You don't know. I think the singer got upset because she felt I was upstaging her, I said. Upstaging her? Yes. The producer kept telling me how great I was sounding. She kept rolling her eyes at me. Were you? Well, now what? Upstaging her? No, I didn't think I was. The child couldn't sing. And so what happened? About an hour later, she ripped off her headphones, stormed into the area where I was singing, and told the producer to fire me. Is that what she said? No. What did she say? Get rid of that black bitch. Was she white? No, she was black, but she was high yeller. Did that bother you? Nobody likes being fired. I wanted that job. It could help me break into the recording industry. Is that it? Is what it? Did it bother you that the singer was fair-skinned? No. Are you sure? I'm sure, I said as I looked at my watch. Why are you looking at your watch? Well, I need to make a stop before I get to the theater. Well, you still have plenty of time, Dr. Huntley said, but I need to go. Why, Nicole? I just do. Is there something else bothering you? No. Okay, Nicole, but I'd like to see you again next week. I think this firing is bothering you more than you'd like to admit. Okay, same time next week. Fine, Dr. Huntley said. I flagged a gypsy taxi from Dr. Huntley's office back to Midtown instead of going directly to the theater. Once I was out of the taxi, I could hear the sounds of a spring New York City evening. All the people walking along the sidewalks were giving me the extra energy I needed. I could tell that spring had started its struggle to leave the island to make room for another sweltering summer. I stopped at a nondescript Chinese restaurant and ordered a pint of shrimp fried rice and some shrimp toast. I decided to take the food to the theater and eat after the curtain went up. I knew Renee would be there. Although she was married, she never seemed to spend time with her husband, even on holidays. I was starting to think that the show would close before I got to go on. Well, at least I would have time to prepare for Wednesday's Bible study. The thought of Bible class brought me a little solace. It took my mind off thinking about how desperately I wanted to do this role and my session with Dr. Huntley. Although this show belonged to the male leads, the role of Anita was pivotal. She was the female lead and had one of the show-stopping numbers at the end of the first act. It was a glamorous role with a lot of sexual overtones and completely different from the roles I'd played previously. I stopped at a newsstand a few blocks from the theater to get some additional reading material in case I finished my Bible study material early. I should have brought the sitcom script just in case I got called in for an early audition. The producers were doing a call in the city before heading back to LA for the final auditions. The prospect of going to Los Angeles didn't excite me, but a chance at a recurring role in a sitcom would be too attractive to turn down. Besides, a trip to the coast might be fun. I arrived at the theater and went backstage. I was greeting various cast members when I noticed a pink note slip on the bulletin board with my name on it. I pulled the note down and saw that it was from my service. A call from Pierce saying he was sending a car for me after the show, and a call from my agent Samantha saying the casting agent from the sitcom wanted me to fly to LA instead of auditioning in New York. Now that was great news to end an otherwise uneventful day. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, child, this man with these long ass chapters, may he rest in peace, but damn it, man. Listen. Okay. Oh, hey, Wings. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Wait a minute. You missed the ending of our last book. Weren't you here? You were here. Weren't you here earlier today? Wings. Huh? I thought you were. Wings. Am I tripping? I could have sworn you was here. Am I tripping? Your phone rang, child. Listen, you better tell your lovers. Tell your lovers, listen, I'm in the speakeasy right now. I can't talk to you, baby. I call you back. Now you behind. Now listen. Here we are. This book is the way it starts is kind of slow, seems like. But I'd heard that. I don't know what y'all think. Y'all want me to keep going or no? I don't know. Because I sure will stop. Y'all know I'll stop. I don't have no problem. I just fixed that person. Not, I'm on do not disturb mode now. You must be at work. It's okay. Y'all listen, when you leave the doors to the speakeasy open, you get all kinds of trash coming in here. We done had some fool coming in here talking about some welfare office. That was the name of their screen name. Talking about flunky moderators. They just be wanting attention. People so slow. They probably done went on about their business. They got what they wanted. Timed out and sent packing. How about that? You want me to keep going? Oh, okay, Kimber, so you liking it? All right, child. Well, I reckon I'll keep on going. Ken said I like it. I know we wanna get to this kabuki. I'm wondering when the kabuki happens. Shit, how many chapters in is the kabuki? Where the fuck is Anthony at? So he can tell us when the kabuki trades show up. That's what I'm waiting to hear about. Y'all listen. I know I got excited when he was talking about the kabuki trade. I was like, wait a minute, what? I hope they describe it. Anyway. Yeah, I know I'd be excited. All right, we're gonna start when we get to the top of the minute. I hope everybody had a good Taco Tuesday, whether you ate tacos. Let me stop. I'm about to say whether you ate tacos or had your taco eaten. Listen, chapter three, Jared. Jared Stovall was the only man I knew who could make me get up at 5:30 a.m. daily. He had that type of power. Each morning at 5:15, my phone would ring and I would hear, "This is your nigga with your wake up call. Get your yellow ass up." Oh my God. We would meet at the Sports Time Health Spa in Buckhead every morning at 6 sharp. Free weights on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and exercise class on Tuesday and Thursday. After a strenuous workout, we'd swim a few laps and then sit in the steam room before starting out for work. We chose early morning because it was less congested than the evenings. Also, the evening traffic at the gym included many distractions of both sexes. This was my reasoning and not necessarily Jared's. Jared beat me swimming and was lying nude in the steam room when I walked in. His body was glistening with baby oil and sweat that had formed into tiny droplets of water. The droplets appeared on every inch of his body, with the exception of the dark brown fig-shaped birthmark that accented his left buttock. "Get in here, slowpoke," Jared said. "Hey, man. Thanks again for last night. I had a great time," I said, looking for a spot in the steam room close to Jared. "I was glad to do it. I got a big kick watching you doing the chop." "Yeah, buddy, it was big fun." I lay on the ceramic tile slab and began to rub my body with baby oil and aloe vera. The steam increased and Jared was no longer visible. I couldn't tell if we were in the room alone or if someone could be eavesdropping. The previous night had been quite magical. Box seats a few rows behind Ted Turner and the mayor. The Braves won in the bottom of the ninth inning. We had two of the best seats in the stadium. Jared and I went to a bar named Tuesdays in the popular underground Atlanta mall after the game and drank Mexican coffee before Jared dropped me off. During the ride home, he quizzed me about the weekend, but when I became evasive, he simply changed the subject back to the thrilling game we had just witnessed. Jared did inquire about Kyle and asked when he was going to get the chance to meet him. I knew that I would have to tell Jared before he met Kyle, but it was a long time to Labor Day and Kyle's first visit to Atlanta. In a way, it was sad that I couldn't share everything with Jared, especially my friendship with Kyle. I wasn't ashamed of Kyle. I was certain that they would love each other when they met. But Kyle's bold confidence regarding his sexuality sometimes caught people off guard, and this was something that could wait until I knew more about Jared's sexuality or his feelings toward gay men. "How does your work week look?" Jared asked. "I don't really know. What about yours?" "It's pretty slow. You know, this race for the Congress is all wrapped up. Congressman Thomas doesn't really have any serious competition. I don't know if I like races like this," Jared lamented. "What? Don't feel like you're earning your money, big boy." "No, it's not that. You know me, I like putting out fires." Jared made no secret about his own political plans. He was gonna head Congressman Thomas's Atlanta office for about 2 years before running for a state Senate seat of his own. Maybe these were two reasons we got along so well, sports and politics. Jared said that if the incumbent ran again in 2 years, he would either move to another district or consider going to law school, skipping the state Senate race, and going straight for the congressional race. There was talk of creating another black majority district in Atlanta area, and Jared hadn't ruled out challenging Congressman Thomas if he became too complacent in Washington. "I'm out of here, Ray Ray. I'll call you later on this afternoon," Jared said as he walked sleepily from the steam room. "Okay, dude, peace out." During the drive to my office, I became consumed with ways of breaking the news to Jared. I practiced what I would say to him, mouthing the words, reacting with my face, and causing strange looks from other motorists at the many stoplights that lined Peachtree Street. Would I tell Jared about my sexuality and then break the news that I was in love with him? What if he was gay or bisexual, but not interested in me? I would be crushed. What would become of our friendship? Maybe I would tell him and then lead him to believe that Kyle and I were lovers, trying to incite a jealous reaction. How was I planning scenarios that danced around the truth? I also had to consider my professional and social standing in Atlanta. If my confession ended my friendship with Jared, then I had to consider the effect that might have on all the people I had met through him, including my employer, Gilliam Battle. I grabbed the stack of messages from my box as I walked through the lobby of my office, located on the 16th floor of the large Midtown Union Bank building. Before I could escape to my office, I heard Miko, Gilliam's legal assistant, call out, "Ray, Gilliam wants me to put you on her schedule today. Morning or afternoon? Did she say what she needed?" I questioned. "Nope," Miko replied. "Okay, let's do it first thing." "Great, I'll check to see if that's all right with Gilliam." I asked my assistant, Melanie, to bring me a cup of coffee and the correspondence that had come during my absence. I wondered what Gilliam wanted. Did she expect details about my trip? I'd lied and told her that I had several leads on players at Howard and Georgetown whom I was going to meet with. Well, I had seen a lot of basketball and football players last weekend, but not in places where I normally met potential new clients. I looked through my messages and mail, nothing important except a handwritten note from a football player at the University of North Carolina expressing his interest in the firms representing him. He was a top draft prospect. Oh, yeah, he was a top draft prospect. Here was some good news that I could get to Gilliam when we met. Gilliam was on the phone, standing in front of her window when I walked into her office. She gave me a smile and waved while she continued her conversation, motioning me to a seat in one of the burgundy leather wing chairs that faced her large glass desk. The walls of her office were painted a soft green with pink borders, the same colors in the Persian rug that covered the hardwood floor. An expensive collection of African art was stationed throughout the office, and Gilliam's various degrees and citations hung directly behind her. Gilliam Battle was a blend of sass and class. A 30-something cinnamon brown beauty with auburn-tinted hair, usually styled in a Dutch boy cut, which always seemed to be perfect. It was as though she went to the beauty shop every morning before coming to the office. She was the type of woman who, as a young girl, probably wouldn't have captured my attention, but who developed into a beauty as an adult. The type who, at a high school reunion, got a lot of, "You are in my high school class?" from incredulous male classmates. Gilliam took a seat in her black leather chair and held up an index finger toward me as she leaned back and let out a brilliant laugh. I enjoyed working for Gillian. She was a powerful and respected lawyer in Atlanta, a graduate of Hampton Institute and Tulane Law School. She'd started the firm more than a decade ago with a college sorority sister and a white male classmate. Her sorority sister had died of breast cancer about 2 years ago, and the other partner had decided to sell his share of the firm and move to the Caribbean so he could sail every day. Gilliam employed eight lawyers, including myself, and often talked about adding a senior partner very soon. This was one of the reasons I jumped at the offer of a position with her firm, in spite of some reservations. I'd heard the horror stories about black men working for black women, but the job market was tight in large cities, and most big law firms were laying off instead of hiring. I didn't know what Gilliam would think if she found out about the secret I was harboring. Black women in the South held pretty strong feelings about gay men, not all of them positive. I thought this was because a lot of black Southern women didn't realize how many gay men they already knew. The majority of black gay and bisexual men lived their lives in the closet, present company included. To Gilliam's credit, she did have Miko as her legal assistant and close confidant, and I could tell Miko was gay from day one. Miko really ran the office and protected Gilliam like a hawk. If he knew my secret, he never let on and treated me with the utmost respect. I didn't know if he would have treated me differently if he'd guessed I was a member of the silent frat, although not an active card-carrying member. Most black gay men were not subscribers of outing. "Ray, welcome back," Gilliam said as she extended her fine bone hands with tastefully polished fingernails. "Glad to be back. How was your weekend?" "Great. I went bungee jumping." "No shit. How was it?" "Oh, it was too wild. Just too much fun. You have to come with me sometime," Gilliam said. "How was the Chocolate City?" "It was all right. I'm glad to be back in Atlanta. How's your schedule in the evening?" "In the evening?" I questioned. "Yes. Let me tell you why I asked. A real good friend of mine called me this weekend inquiring about your interest and availability for teaching a class over at AU Center." "The AU Center? I didn't realize they had a law school. First class enters this fall. I think it'll be great for the community." "What class would I be teaching?" "Sports and entertainment law. You and I could share the load." "Hey, this sounds like a great opportunity for the firm and me," I said excitedly. "Yeah, it would be. Should be an excellent experience," Gilliam said. "When do you need to know?" "The middle of June." "Okay, let me make sure I don't have any commitments I can't get out of." "Okay, how are the prospects?" "Prospects? Yes. Didn't you see some players in DC?" "Oh, yeah. Don't think we should put a lot of energy there. The prospects don't look good that either one of them will be drafted." "Okay, don't look good. Yeah. Smart kids, though. Okay, you know I trust your judgment. Is that all?" "Yes, unless you have something." As I started out of the office, Gilliam called out, "Ray, what are you doing next Sunday?" No big plans. Well, I want to invite you to my church. Would you be interested? Church? Yeah, we just moved into a new building. I was on the building fund, and I'm really quite proud of our new church. What church do you attend? First Birth. It's in Decatur. Sure, Gillian. Thanks for asking. I'm embarrassed to tell you that I haven't been to church since I moved to Atlanta. You really shouldn't be embarrassed. I'm just sorry I didn't ask you earlier. When I got back into my office, I thought about Gilliam's invitation. I wondered if this was a date, and if so, if it was a wise decision to date the boss. I guess I'd forgotten that Gilliam wasn't married, and I'd never seen her with a man. Not that we socialized a lot outside the office. I mean, Gilliam was beautiful, smart, and rich. Why didn't she have a man? Okay, child, that's the end of that chapter. Well, she's beautiful, smart, and rich. Maybe she didn't want a man. Maybe a battery operated or a USB charged boyfriend was enough for her. I don't know. Oh, okay. Wing said I'm off tonight looking for some tacos to munch on. Listen, I had just said, listen. I don't know if you ate tacos or had your taco eaten. Anybody have their taco eaten today? Listen, I'm all up in y'all business. Raise your hand if somebody ate your taco today. Doggone it. Anyway, let me keep on going here. Oh, back to day shift in the morning. Really? Aw, man. So wait, you only work nights on the weekends? Is that what the deal is? Or your working night shifts is over, period? I'm all up in your schedule and all up in your business. Hold on, y'all. Give me one second. All right. Thank you for your patience, y'all. So you rotating shifts all the time. Okay, child. Listen, I ain't even know. I didn't know that. So you got to be to work in the morning. Okay. Got you. All right. Let me make sure I got a I don't know if my mods came back in the building or no. I know, child, one of them is probably knocked out. Hold on, let me see something. Oh, somebody. Child, I don't even know who this is. I have people requesting to follow me. Oh, okay. Well, they're followed by somebody else, so I guess I'll let them own in the dough. I don't know how I am. I be real weird. Okay. Okay. I be nervous, child. Listen. People be tripping. Tripping, tripping, tripping. All right, so let me get on back to the book here. Okay. I'll give y'all a few more chapters. All right. I'm sorry you gotta go to work tomorrow, Wings. But that's all right. Work is good for the soul. Chapter 4, Until It Ain't. I was almost out the door on my way to Newark Airport when the phone rang. I paused as the answering machine clicked on. It was Samantha, my agent. I quickly dropped my luggage and grabbed the phone as Samantha started a panic-stricken message. Hold on, Sam, I'm here, I said. Nicole, I'm glad I caught you before you left for the airport. I'm afraid I have some bad news. What? Just got a call from the producers of the sitcom. They've already cast the role. They're still interested in you for a one-shot guest appearance, though, Sam said. Dang, Sam, I really wanted that role, I sighed. Yes, I know it would have been a great opportunity. Are you interested in a guest spot? Do you know who got the job? Please don't say Halle Berry or Jasmine Guy, I pleaded. I'm not certain, but I think the Ralph girl. That doesn't make me feel much better. Let me get back to you, Sam, on the guest spot. I need to digest this first. Okay, don't wait too long. A lot of actresses will be lined up for this shot, Sam suggested. Don't worry. I'll let you know this afternoon. Bye, Sam. I'll talk to you, Nicole. I know this is a bad way to start your day. Don't worry, I'll be fine. This is one of the hazards of the business, right? Yes, you're absolutely right. I stood in the middle of my living room with my luggage at my side and contemplated what to do. A part of me wanted to cry, but a part of me was relieved. I mean, I wasn't completely sold on moving to the West Coast, even for the 4 to 6 months shooting a series would require. But the part would have been a big break. A role on a television series would finally let the people in Sweet Home know that I had made it. It was funny how, despite the fact that I had 3 Broadway shows under my belt, most of my townspeople and even my mother kept asking me, when was I going to be on a television show or have a song on the radio? And if I wasn't on television soon, then why didn't I move back home and start a family? Damn, that show is nosy. They thought of Broadway as a type of high school plaything and didn't consider me a real actress like Diane Carroll or Whoopi Goldberg. I think they were more excited when I was chosen for Up With People than when I secured the lead in a Broadway show. They could relate to that. Broadway theater, like New York City, was as foreign as China. They didn't quite understand that Broadway was a long way from Up With People. I was happy that my daddy got the chance to see me on the Broadway stage before he died. Oh, well, thank you. I'm glad Love Jones here, child. Listen. Okay. I don't think that he or my mother understood how important opening night was, but I knew they were both proud, and that's what really counted. This wasn't the first time my parents had shown support for something they didn't quite understand. They'd never understood why I'd kept entering beauty pageants and why I was usually the only black girl. My mother's pride seemed to be even greater if another black girl was in the pageant. She happened to be a light skinned, and I finished higher than she did. It didn't matter to her that a white girl usually beat the both of us. In the South, as a dark-skinned black girl, I'd had to compete not only against white women, but with women of my own race with lighter-hued skin. At least in my mother's eyes. When I finished as third runner-up and then first runner-up for Miss Arkansas in consecutive years, my mother suggested I try Miss Black Arkansas or give up pageants altogether. The 1 year I represented Spelman College in the Miss Georgia pageant, my daddy made the trip alone. I tried to explain to them that the scholarships were better in the Miss America program and what a great stepping stone it would be for my career in show business. Despite their misgivings, I don't think anyone yelled any louder when I finally won on my fourth try at a trip to Atlantic City. My parents usually offered one voice when it came to dealing with Michael, my brother, and me. But this changed when it came to my current foe, Dr. Pierce Gessler. My daddy was okay about it. I'm sure he wanted me to marry a black man, but he also wanted me to be happy. He was his usual compassionate self when he met Pierce in my New York. In New York. My mother was icy cold toward him, and when Daddy died, she was adamant about my not bringing Pierce anywhere near Arkansas and my daddy's funeral. I didn't press the issue and returned home alone. I didn't know if my mother would ever accept my relationship with Pierce. I don't think that my mother was prejudiced. Well, maybe she was just a little bit, but she had grown up in the Old South, and I knew that there were certain things that she found hard to forget or accept. But she never liked Oh, she never talked with me. What the? She never talked with me about those things. And Daddy would always say, "That's your mother. God bless her. She's been through a lot." What the hell type of bullshit excuse is that? I know you lying. That's not the excuse. What the hell? I would question my mother on why she felt this way about white people, she simply replied, "If you're lucky enough to live as long as I have, you'll learn how they are." Her comment had a familiar ring. White people often express the same sentiment about blacks. Hush, Marva. Since my travel plans had been changed, I now had a free day and evening, and I decided to take Pierce to lunch and meet Kyle and Delaney that evening. A busy schedule allowed little time to do things with my friends outside the theater and for Pierce. Pierce was constantly surprising me with gifts and small acts of kindness, and I wanted to show him that his kindness didn't go unnoticed. When he couldn't pick me up at the theater, he would send a car for me because he didn't want me on the subway late at night. He insisted that I carry a can of mace with me at all times and that I never, ever catch a gypsy cab. Not a day passed without his telling me how much he loved me and how special I was. There were times when I felt a bit smothered with all his attention, and I didn't always welcome feeling like a prized possession. During the times I felt this way, I could just hear my mother admonishing me to be careful what you pray for. I'd met Pierce during my audition for my last Broadway show. He was one of the primary financial backers for the show, and when the director had kept me late one night going over lyrics, Pierce had offered me a ride home when he saw me outside the theater hailing a taxi. At first, we were just friends. I was still grieving over Candace's death and the end of my relationship with Raymond, and Pierce was going through a messy divorce. The therapy helped a great deal, but Dr. Huntley was not available 24/7. I thought of Candace and how much I missed her every day. I guess 3 years was not a long time to grieve for someone so important to you. As far as I was concerned, there would never be enough time. Pierce and I would console each other on bad days, and I think we were enjoying learning about our differences. I was very interested in the Jewish religion, and Pierce was interested in my Southern upbringing. There was not a single Jewish person in Sweet Home. Although I did have Jewish classmates in my large Little Rock High School, my other white classmates, my daddy told me stories of how Jewish people had helped during the civil rights movement and how they were different from regular white folks. I wanted to learn more about those differences. After a few years of living in New York, I became pretty good at spotting Jewish people without asking dumb questions. They had a certain pride about their heritage that was sadly missing from a lot of the African Americans I came in contact with. Well, Miss Missy, that's because they don't fucking know it, because their own fucking heritage has basically been shielded from them, stolen, technically, and then made a mockery of. Child, listen, get your ass out of here, little girl. Clearly, you don't know who the fuck you are. Anyway, this book I see gonna piss me off. This hoe is dumb. Anyway, pardon me. Y'all know how I feel about a dumb hoe. Anyway, sorry. Pierce was a native New Yorker and had taken over his father's successful East Side obstetrical gynecological practice. His love for the theater had led him into investing in Broadway shows. I didn't know how wealthy he was, but it was plain as day that he never wanted for anything. Pierce was tall and straight, and he was pronouncedly pigeon-toed. Listen, how you know he's straight, Miss Mammy Ma'am? You don't, girl. He could be as gay as a pride parade on the first Saturday of the month. You don't know that. Why? Because he white and he told you so? Child, listen. He had a bony, handsome look about him, marred only by his slightly large nose and thin lips. His onyx-rich black hair brought attention to his olive complexion and brown-green eyes. Those eyes, big eyes, lively and intelligent, with an airy trace of pretense. Child, please, he a whole liar. I was a sucker for a man's eyes. Raymond had beautiful, sleepy green eyes. Bedroom eyes. When I looked into Pierce's eyes, it was like looking deep into his soul, and sometimes I remembered Raymond Tyler. I bet you did. Pierce understood my reluctance about sex when I shared my relationship with Raymond and what happened with Candace. He offered to take an HIV test when I felt I was ready to pursue a physical relationship. He gave me valuable insight on why Candace had died so quickly from AIDS, explaining how women were often wrongly diagnosed because the diseases affecting women were different from those men experienced. I hadn't determined if I was going to take my relationship with Pierce to the next level, a sexual relationship. There were times when I felt I loved him, but I couldn't distinguish if it was friendship love or romantic love. I admitted I had not felt a spasm of sexual attraction toward him, but this could be because of my focus on celibacy. Or the fact I had never slept with a white man, Jewish or otherwise. Girl, you know if you want to fuck this man or not, and you clearly don't. It ain't nothing stirring in your pussy, you don't want to fuck him. Pardon my crassness, but real is real. Pierce was already at the restaurant on 86th and Broadway when I arrived a few minutes late. Well, it was more like a half hour late, but as usual, Pierce seemed happy to see me. He looked at his watch and let out a big grin. Sorry I'm running a little bit late, I said, as I kissed him on his clean-shaven face. He pulled back my chair. No, you're not, but I've been keeping myself busy, Pierce said, as he closed up his black portable phone and took the seat to my immediate left instead of the one facing me. What are you drinking, I asked. Chardonnay, is that what you want? No, I think I'll just have iced tea. So, how are you doing, Pierce asked. I'm doing okay. How about you? I'm doing great now. Pierce caught the attention of our waiter who was standing at the door leading to the outdoor cafe looking bored. I need an iced tea for this beautiful lady, Pierce shouted. What do you suggest? I inquired as I looked over the colorful and busy menu. All the food is great here, especially the seafood. Why don't you order for me? I said. Pierce ordered blackened catfish with baked potatoes for the both of us, and we decided to share a basket of chili cheese fries before our entrees were served. I told Pierce about the sitcom disappointment. He was very understanding and supportive, telling me my day was going to come soon. I called you late last night. Where were you? Pierce asked. His supportive tone had changed. What time? It was way past midnight. You should have been home from the theater. Wasn't the car on time? Yes, it was on time, but you know I turn my phone and answering machine off when I go to sleep, I said. Maybe I should get you a beeper, Pierce said in a slightly annoyed tone. A beeper? You've got to be kidding. No, I'm serious. This was one of the things about Pierce that didn't sit too well with me. What did he think? That I was out with someone else? We'll talk about this later, Pierce said. Suit yourself, I said, shaking my head in dismay. The waiter appeared and served our fish and potatoes. Child, if this don't sound like Sippy and Derek's redneck racist ass, I don't know what does. Let me mind my goddamn business. The food was substantial but tasteless. Maybe I had eaten too many chili cheese fries. As I toiled with my fish, Pierce's voice suddenly became very animated. Well, I've got some news that will brighten your day, Pierce said as he moved the glass of wine from his lips and placed it next to his half-full plate. Oh, yeah, I said dryly, still annoyed about the beeper suggestion. One of my good friends called me a couple of weeks ago with an opportunity to invest in another Broadway show. It's bound to be a hit because the Schuberts are the primary investors, he said in a cool voice. Oh, that's great. What's the show? I asked, knowing full well that it had to be a white show. Why else wouldn't I have heard about it? You'll never guess, Pierce laughed with his boyish giggle. What, Jerome Robbins 2? I said sarcastically. No, a musical about the Anita Hill Clarence Thomas debacle, Pierce explained. You're kidding, I responded, dropping my fork. They're going to make a musical about that mess? Calm down, Nicole, Pierce said as he backed away from me and the checkered cloth-covered table. Pierce, that hearing was an embarrassment for this nation, especially black people and women. Wait until you see the script before you pass judgment, Pierce said. See the script? Yes. It could be a great role for you. I think you should look at it. You think so? Yes. At least go to an audition. Well, maybe you're right. I am tired of just sitting behind stage every night. I wonder if Sam is setting up an audition. Don't worry about Samantha. Smiling at me, Pierce reached for his portable phone and dialed a number. While he was punching the buttons, I changed my attitude about the musical. This could be a great opportunity for me. Moments later, I heard him say, I was right, she is interested. And then he gently closed up the phone. It's all set. be it a story or rehearsal hall Friday at 4, Pierce instructed. You're kidding, right? I have to tell my agent. No, that's also set. Have a ballad and an up-tempo number. Sing like I know you can. Sing and, oh, sorry, this thing is, sorry, that thing came across my screen. Sing like I know you can sing, and I think we'll have our Anita. Oh, Pierce, this is wonderful. You're wonderful, I said with excitement as I reached over and kissed him on his dry lips. Why's lips gotta be dry? Jesus Louises. I looked into his eyes and saw the surprise in them and the reflection of my own eyes that mirrored Pierce's dazed look. The warm light in his eyes made something intimate out of the moment. I wanted to stay and enjoy the good news with Pierce, but there was so much work to do. I needed to pick out a couple of songs and decide what to wear. Plus, I couldn't wait to tell Kyle and Delaney. Pierce said he understood as he gave me another kiss and hailed a cab for me. Kyle and Delaney seemed even more excited about my prospects for the new Broadway show than I was. We met later that evening at my apartment, opting for pizza delivery so that they could help me get ready for my audition on Friday. Kyle was going through my closet, laying different outfits for me to wear on the bed. Delaney was going through Billboard magazine for song suggestions, and I was going through my sheet music collection of old standards. Why don't you sing Save the Best for Last, Delaney suggested, the Vanessa Williams song. Oh, I love that song, I said. Yeah, sing that, Kyle yelled from my bedroom. You know, next to you two, Miss Vanessa is my girl. Kyle walked into the living room carrying my tight black spandex dress. He had a broad smile on his face. Here it is, Miss Honey. This is the dress, he boasted. Yes, yes, you better work, girl, Delaney chirped in agreement. You think so? I asked. Oh, yeah, Nicole, even I think about it. Changing my religion when I see you in this dress. It will wear the kids out, Kyle said. I think he's... Did you spray something? Jesus, it's taking my breath away. What the holy fucking hell? I'm sorry. Oh, my God, I can't fucking breathe. I know you were trying to be nice. I'm sorry. Oh my God. Okay. It caught me off guard. Okay. I think he's right, Nick. I'm sorry. Oh, yeah, I know it don't take but a couple things to get me tickled. Go and try it on. While I changed into the dress, I heard Vanessa Williams' voice floating in the air of my apartment. Someone was switching the CD tracks until the player arrived on Save the Best for Last. Yes, this was the dress and that was the ballad, I thought. Now all I needed was an up-tempo number and an easy hairstyle. Maybe I would wear it down or maybe up in a tight chignon. I'd ask Delaney and see if she could come and help me. I brushed out my hair, put on my diamond studs, and prepared to walk back into my living room. Kyle and Delaney's reaction would tell me if this was right. Before I could leave the bedroom, my phone rang. Hello? Nikki, you know who this is? Of course, nobody calls me Nikki but my baby brother, I said. How you doing, sweetheart? I'm good. What about you? Well, I've been better, Michael said in a distressed tone. What's the matter, Michael? I need to ask a favor. I run into some hard times and I need to borrow some money before I get evicted. What about your job? Mama told me you had a great job. Don't tell Mama, but I got laid off. Why not tell her? You know her. She'll worry about nothing. Is it nothing, Michael? Yes, Nikki. I'll be fine if you help me out this time. How much do you need? $1,500. $1,500? Michael, that's a lot of money. I know, Nikki, but I promise to pay you back once I get back on my feet. Well, let me see what I can do. Let me make sure I have your address. I'll send it next day mail. Can you send it Western Union first thing in the morning? Western Union? Well, okay, sure. You have ID, don't you? Yes. If you got a major credit card, you can do it right now, Michael suggested. You need it that quickly? Yes, big sis, I do, Michael said sadly. Okay, give me a couple of hours. If you don't hear from me, then you know I did it. Is your phone number still the same? Yes. Thanks, baby. Now, please, promise me you won't say anything to Mama. I won't, You take care of yourself. I will. I love you, Nikki, Michael said. Yes, I love you too, baby. When I hung up the phone, I grabbed my purse, pulled my Visa from my wallet, and called information to get the number for Western Union. While I was waiting for an answer, I wondered if Michael was telling me the truth, what had happened to all the money he'd got from Daddy's insurance policy, and why he didn't want me to mention this to Mama. Lord knows she had spent her life spoiling Michael. Their relationship was always much closer than the one I shared with her. I was just happy he wasn't in any kind of trouble, or at least I prayed he wasn't in any kind of trouble. I finished the transaction for Michael. The moment I walked into the living room, Kyle started squealing with delight as he waved both hands in the air and pranced a little jig. Delaney put her long fingers to her chin and walked around me, nodding with approval. You go, girl, Kyle said. Girl, they can tell the rest of those divas to stay at home. Here is our Miss Anita, Delaney said. What took you so long? I guess it takes extra time to get an address like that. No, girl, it takes no time. I had an important phone call. Who, Pierce? Delaney asked. No, my little brother needed to borrow some money, I said. Is he all right? Kyle asked. I think so. Oh, Nicole, this is going to be it, Kyle said, changing the subject. I can see your name on the marquee right above the title. I wonder who they're going to get to play Clarence, Kyle questioned. I love your faith in me, but I haven't got the part yet. What if they've already cast it, I muttered. Oh, don't worry about that, Delaney said. Yes, Miss Thing, no man in his right mind would turn you down if he sees you in this dress, Kyle said. You two are so crazy. Thanks a million for being my friends, I said, as my eyes began to mist, and Delaney came over and the three of us hugged each other. I briefly closed my eyes to keep the tears of joy inside. As I opened them, I spotted a thin slice of street light that entered the living room from the open window. I felt Kyle's and Delaney's hands gently massage my neck, and I thought how blessed I truly was. Silently, I mouthed a prayer of thanks. And that's the end of that chapter. Listen, I am bothered. Like, okay, the beeper thing, like, this dude, what is the deal with this dude with the beeper? Yes, he's acting like Derek from P-Valley with Sippy. Tell me some, you need a beeper. Where was you at last night? Don't take the sub. Okay, I get the subway. Don't take the subway. But don't take a gypsy cab. Okay, maybe that's a good idea, too. But damn, you know what I'm saying? Like, what the whole entire hell? What do y'all think about that? One second, you guys. Oh, hey, Anthony. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And I'm glad you're here, Love Jones. I really am. Hey, Kim Bird. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Y'all give me one second here. All right. So, yeah, I'm kind of worried about this creep staying Pierce. The Jewish doctor, the Jewish gynecologist, he's gonna be all up and through her coochie. Watch, he gonna suggest it. He do the test and this and that. Child, listen, yes, too controlling for my liking. See, it's the difference between, you know, being the you know, the sigma male type that makes you, you know, want to just do things that they suggest, you know. But I'm talking about the fact that this dude is like, we're going to have to get you a beeper. And I was like, bruh, you better pump your fucking brakes. And if your brakes are failing, you better hop your ass out the car. Stop, drop, and roll like your asshole's on fire. Who the hell you think you are? You ain't running shit around here but your mouth. And you're running up a tab because I'm about to drink you under the table, eat you out of house and home, and then I'm going to tell you, fuck you. I don't need you. She don't have any sort of sexual ties to this fool. Who the hell does he think he is? Oh, really? Well, I've never had a sugar daddy before. I've only ever been married. But, well, I guess you could say he's my sugar daddy. He makes me melt. I don't, anyway, stay out of my business, Anthony. Anyway, Is that how sugar daddies behave like that? I thought they just gave you money and told you, please don't fuck anybody else. Do they really be trying to lay down rules and shit? I heard Drake be wanting to put bitches up in places and keep them away from people or whatever have you, but you know, like he pull them out the strip club and lock them away in some place. Sounds too R. Kelly-ish to me. But like, what the whole hell? I didn't know that that's how sugar daddies behave. The ones I've ever heard about just give you some money and going on about their business and just be like, please don't fuck nobody else. And if you need anything, call me. Oh, okay. All right then. Now I got you. So she gonna have to suck a little peen in order to get this role. Well, don't tell me. Don't get a book away. I'm just wondering what's gonna have to happen. Child, listen. Okay, let me get into the next chapter, child. Oh my God, he writes such long ass chapters. Good googling, moogly. One second, y'all. Okay, so the modern version of the casting couch, yes. That's Harvey Weinstein. Child, listen, I don't like that. Oh, Lord have mercy. I'm a little warm. You warm? Well, I am. Can you please cool it off in here? Okay. I'm sorry. Well, I'm hoping that he don't have to let's see. Chapter 5. Free Leona Helmsley headquarters. The familiar voice on the other end of the phone said, "Kyle," I quizzed. "Ray, what's going on, child? What did you say when you answered the phone?" "Free Leona," he laughed. "You're one sick puppy," I said. "But that's why you love me so. Where have you been?" "I've been calling all night. Can I please have a life? I've been up at Nicole's place. How is she doing? Did you give her my message?" "Gorgeous as ever, and no, I didn't, because this white man is helping her career. She'd be a fool to let him go when she doesn't have to fuck him," Kyle admonished. "What are you talking about?" "Well, he's loaded. Nicole has an audition for a Broadway musical he's backing. She's gonna play Anita Hill." "Anita Hill? You're shitting me. They're making a musical out of that? And you know it. White folks ain't gonna never let us forget that mess." Kyle and I talked about Nicole for a few more minutes and how this might really be her big break. The last time I had any direct contact with Nicole was on her opening night a couple of years ago. I was going to show up and surprise her, but I chickened out at the last minute and just sent 100 roses, something I'd done often during our courtship. She called me late that night when I was asleep to thank me. At least, I think she called. It could have been a dream. When I talked to Kyle, I could sometimes hear the faint sounds of the city in the background. I pictured him sitting on the window sill or floor of my old New York apartment. It was during these conversations that I so missed New York. So, what have you been up to since you got back? Same old stuff. Out here beating the pavement, Kyle said. Any good leads? Yes, everything is fine. Actually, I've got more work than I can handle. How's your love life? Any new men? What love life? What men? Now don't tell me you haven't been meeting some new men, I said. Ray, I'm so sick and tired of being sick and tired of niggas and all their shit. I long for a date where I don't have to hide my wallet and watch. What about you? How's Jared? I didn't tell him, Kyle. What are you waiting on? Kyle asked. I don't know. I'm really scared Jared is either going to be upset or that he already has a lover. Well, you won't know until you confront the issue, Ray. Act like you're in court and he's under cross-examination. Besides, if he has a lover, don't you think you'd know? Yeah, I guess you're right. What else is new? Kyle joked. I shared with Kyle Jared's welcome home surprise and what a magical evening it had been. Also told him about Gilliam's invitation and asked him what I should do if she came on to me. Well, you might have to fuck her, Kyle said, but I think that's sexual harassment, he teased. Come on, Kyle, this is serious. Maybe it's all innocent. Ray, you need to get some. I don't care from who, male or female. I think all that semen is backed up in your brain. Now, I release myself by myself, I defended. Ray, listen to me. This is what you do. Invite Jared to your place. Cook a fabulous dinner for two. Have lots and lots of champagne. And then look him in the eyes with those killer eyes of yours and say, Jared, I'm a punk. He'll understand that, Kyle laid out. Why did I call you? Because you knew I'd tell you the truth. Oh, before I forget, I got a card and picture of J.J., Bernard, and Christopher, I said. I got one, too. Doesn't she look wonderfully happy? Christopher is going to be a killer, Kyle said. Yep, it seems like only yesterday, the three of us were in my apartment and J.J. told us she was pregnant, I recall. Janelle or J.J., as she preferred. I thought her ass preferred Janelle now, all of a sudden. Hold on, y'all. Where's my moderator? She must be busy. I got it. Don't worry about it. I got it. Okay, I'll report them to. Shall I be trying to report each one, but anybody got time for that right now? Okay. I thought she preferred to be called Janelle once she got with Bernard. But anyway. Anyway, okay, so JJ, as she preferred, was the female member of my New York trio. We know she played an important part in the development of my feeling totally comfortable around a woman who was aware of my sexuality. But things had changed drastically in Janelle's life. She'd married a former New York City bus driver and moved to Charlotte, North Carolina with her husband, Bernard. Her son, Christopher, was born shortly after. See, that's what a good man will do for you. Miss Thing isn't a fag hag anymore, Kyle laughed. Hey, you want to call her? I've got three-way calling, I said. Yeah, let's surprise her. Hold on, I said, as I clicked my phone line over. I dialed JJ's number, and a few seconds later, I heard the phone ringing. I then clicked back over to Kyle. Kyle, you there? It's ringing, I said. I'm here, Kyle said. Hello, the deep male voice said. Bernard, I quizzed. Yes, how you doing? This is Raymond Tyler and Kyle Benton, I said. Hey, Bernard, Kyle said. Hey, guys, what a nice surprise. How you two doing? How's New York City? You guys keeping it safe for the rest of the world? That's Kyle's job. I live in Atlanta, I said. Oh, yeah, I forgot, Ray. Janelle told me that. Why haven't you visited us living so close by? I'm going to do that real soon, Bernard, I promise. Where's your wife? Downstairs in the laundry room. I'll get her. Good talking to you two, Bernard said. Same here, Bernard, I said. Yeah, me too, Kyle added. While we were waiting for JJ to come to the phone, Kyle commented on how sexy Bernard's voice sounded. Child, Bernard's voice got my juices flowing. Can you imagine Miss JJ washing dirty diapers, he joked. Hello, you two divas from hell, JJ's sweet-sounding voice said. Divas? You're the one, Kyle said. Hey, Janelle, how's it going, I asked. I'm doing great. What about you two? Can't complain. I can, but Ray's paying for this call, and we don't have enough time, Kyle said. Janelle told us about her busy life in North Carolina, informing us that she was now working on her master's in child psychology at Johnson C. Smith University. Yes, that's what we need. She spoke proudly of Christopher and what a great and gifted child he was, and of how she and Bernard were talking about having another child when Christopher reached four. Bernard was running his father's garage, and their sex life was better than ever. It doesn't get much better than this, JJ said. Bitch, I hate you, Kyle said. You are evil and must be destroyed, he joked. JJ, I'm really happy for you, I said. So you two still single? JJ asked. Yes, I said. Me too, Kyle said. But I haven't given up. I ride the bus every chance I get looking for my Bernard. Okay, hold on, y'all. Okay, now that was the 190, wasn't it? Queen, please be quiet. It was the 103. Ray, when are you coming to visit? Janelle asked. Well, Kyle says he's coming to Atlanta Labor Day. Maybe we'll drive up then, I said. Yes, we should do that, Kyle said. That would be great. We're adding a room to the house and it'll be finished by then, JJ said. That sounds great. So, you sure you two are doing all right, JJ quiz? I'm doing okay, I said. Yeah, me too, but sometimes I don't know if I should shoot myself or go bowling, Kyle joked. Well, kids, my other child is calling. This has been fun. I can't tell you how much I miss you two, JJ said. Yeah, I miss you too, I said. Me too, Kyle said. I love you, Raymond. I love you, Kyle, JJ said. I love you, JJ. Give Christopher a hug, I said. What is this, the colored Waltons, Kyle said. Y'all, I hated that fucking show. That fucking show was annoying. Did y'all ever? I don't know how many of y'all in here are even old enough to even know. Listen, it was every night when the show would go off. When the show would go off at the end, it's not every night, but at night when the show would go off, they would do this whole good night. Everybody in the house is like, good night, John Boy. Good night, Mom. Good night, Dad. Good night, good night, good night, good night. Like, I was like, oh, shut up. Everybody say good night. Like, good night, y'all. Good night. That's it. Knock it the fuck off. All the good night to every single person in the house. It was annoying. I hated that fucking show. Anyway, I see he hasn't changed a bit, JJ said. You guys take care. I wonder if somebody got that on YouTube somewhere. Good night at the Waltons. I'm sure if you type that in, child, you'll hear the whole thing. It was fucking annoying. We will, Kyle. Hang on the line. Bye, JJ, I said. I love you, JJ, Kyle said. You better. Bye. Stay sweet and be safe. And JJ said as she disconnected from our three-way conversation. When she hung up, the sound of Kyle's voice changed to a depressed tone. Ray, you still there? He asked. Yes, buddy, I'm still here. Janelle sounds so happy. Yeah, Kyle sighed. What's wrong? Ray, do you think our lives will ever be that happy? Kyle asked with a melancholy edge in his voice. Yeah, buddy. One day very soon, I assured him. You promise? Kyle asked with the innocent voice of a child. I promise. And that's the end of that chapter. Wait a minute. Choco Chip said I hated that show. Child, listen, it's good to know I'm not the only one. Child, listen, that shit was annoying. The whole fucking show just sucked donkey ass. My mother loved that shit, but that's more her shit than ever could have ever been. I hated that fucking show. See that shit right there. Good night, Raymond. Good night, Nicole. Good night, Saki. And then it's like, good night, Anthony. Good night, so like everybody took a turn. Six, like, shut the. Listen. Good night on three. One, two, three. Bam. That's it. All this back and forth screaming through the house. Shut up, Wash. Okay, it'll take 15 minutes to say goodnight. Shit, now I'm wide awake again and need a fucking snack. Get out of here. Yes, poor white trash in the mountains. That's exactly what it was, Anthony. Listen, and they're probably the fucking owners of Walmart while you bullshitting. But anyway, because aren't those folks the Waltons too? Oh, good googly moogly. All right, so let's do this one more chapter, child, and then I'm going to get the hell out of here. Because I have to let my peoples go to bed. Chapter 6. I was nervous about my audition and upset with Pierce's beeper suggestion. Oh, well, go ahead on, child. That's your people. Go ahead on. go to hell right on with them. The combination led me to Dr. Huntley's office for the second time during the week. Thank God she'd had a cancellation. He wants me to wear a beeper. A beeper? Who, Nicole? Pierce. And he is dead serious, I said. How does that make you feel? Dr. Huntley asked. Like a possession. A possession? Yes, like the time he paraded me in front of his family and friends and kept commenting on how much I look like Diane Carroll. That bothered you? At first I was flattered, but then, a couple of days later, I was talking to my mother, telling her about meeting Pierce's parents. I told her what he said. My mother pointed out I was darker than her. But that was your mother, Dr. Huntley observed. Yes. I don't think Pierce means anything by it. Maybe it's a white thing. A white thing. How so? You know, being in control. How does saying you look like Diane Carroll mean he's looking for control? Well, sometimes he makes strong suggestions on what I should wear when I'm meeting friends of his. What about what your mother said? Oh, that's just the way she is. Dr. Huntley didn't respond. This was one of those times when her eyes spoke for her. It was so quiet, I heard someone running upstairs in Dr. Huntley's brownstone. I wondered if it was one of her children. Doesn't that sound racist, I asked. What? Pierce and control. How a lot of people think white men always have to be in control no matter what, I said. Does it? I don't know. What do you think? Well, you haven't brought the race issue up when it comes to your relationship with Pierce. You only seem to bring it up when talking about other black people, Dr. Huntley observed. I don't understand, Dr. Huntley. What are you talking about? Well, you always mention the color of your black friends using terms like light, black, brown. Yes, I guess I do. Do you have any idea why? No. Dr. Huntley didn't say anything. She started to move from side to side in her chair, looking directly at me with an unreadable expression. Maybe it goes back to my childhood. I don't know if I told you, but my brother is very light-skinned. I'm sorry, there I go again. Well, anyhow, whenever my brother really wanted to make me mad, he would call me Black Fang. And when he really wanted to get me, he would say Blue Black. What would you do? I'd cry. Why? Because sometimes words hurt. It still doesn't explain why you never bring up race when talking or dealing with Pierce. Well, we both know it's there. It being the difference in our color and religion, but I think ignoring it means it will never be an issue in our relationship. How would you respond if a black man suggested you carry a beeper? What if Raymond had asked you? Raymond would never do that. You're sure? I'm sure. If he asked me, I'd ask why and we would discuss it. Did you ask Pierce? No, not really. I think you should, but I still don't think it will answer why you both seem to be avoiding the race issue. It's something to think about. Well, why bring it up if it hasn't been a problem? That's one way of dealing with it, Dr. Huntley said as she picked her watch up from the desk. My time was up. The cool air conditioning in the empty theater caused a bit of concern for me. What if it affects my voice? I tried to take my mind off the cool air while going over the lyrics for the ballad I'd prepared for the audition. I should have scheduled Dr. Huntley for after the audition. All that talking was not good for the vocal cords. This wasn't a typical audition. With the exception of a few stagehands, backstage was totally empty. Most auditions I'd attended in the past included every black actress who was a member of SAG. Samantha had told me the producers had held open auditions for SAG and non-SAG actors for 2 days prior. One of the rituals of auditions in the past was psyching out the competition with your voice, dance movements, or your attire. When that didn't work, divas would start to verbalize their resumes. I went against the advice of Kyle and Delaney and chose to wear a blue silk suit with a black leotard top instead of the black spandex dress. I was going for the role of Anita Hill, and I doubted very seriously that Anita owned a spandex dress of any color. I wore very little makeup and had pulled my hair back into a tight chignon that brought attention to my diamond stud earrings, a gift from Raymond, and to the pendant that my daddy had given me before my first pageant. I was looking in a mirror, tucking tiny strands of hair back into place when I suddenly heard my name called. Nicole Springer, the deep baritone voice said. I quickly grabbed my sheet music from Oh my goodness, girl. From my bag and darted toward the empty stage. "What are you going to sing for us?" the voice asked from the dark in the orchestra section. "Save the best for last," I responded. "Great, have at it," the faceless voice said. I walked over to the heavy-set blonde sitting at the piano, gave her a smile, handed her the sheet music, and then walked to the center of the stage. I looked at the pianist and signaled that I was ready. Just 30 seconds into the song, I heard the voice again. "Thank you, that was great. Do you have an up-tempo number?" "Yes," I said, realizing that I'd left my other sheet music at home. I walked over to the piano and asked the accompanist, if she knew the Diana Ross version of Why Do Fools Fall in Love. She smiled and directed her head toward the center stage, giving me the signal to return to my designated spot. When she began to play, I started snapping my fingers to add a beat to the single instrument. Again, just as I was getting into the song, I heard the voice once more. "Thanks. Samantha Walker is your agent, right?" "Yes." "Great. Thank you. We'll be in touch." I walked to the piano and mouthed a thank you to the lady and started toward backstage. I noticed several male dancers going through stretch motions as I looked for my bag. I overheard one of the guys say that Robin Givens was up for the leading female role. I didn't realize Robin sang or danced. She was Robin Givens, so what difference did that make? "We'll be in touch," I thought. That couldn't be a good sign. They didn't ask me to dance or read. And why did I choose that dreadful Diana Ross song? I was used to sealing the deal with my up-tempo numbers. Oh, well, I sighed as I pushed the heavy steel door. At least I have a job. I wasn't performing, but I was getting a paycheck. I stepped out onto 43rd Street and headed toward Broadway. I was going to meet Delaney at JR's. She was taping a rap video at Radio City Music Hall. It was times like this when I envied Delaney. She would audition one day and shoot the next. The turnaround would be swift and stress-free, or so it seemed. It might be weeks before I heard the bad news about this job. As I walked down Broadway, I convinced myself that I didn't want the part. The show was bound to be controversial. It would mean 12-hour rehearsal days and then the possibility of out-of-town tryouts, only to return and close in a night if the New York Times critic didn't like the show. Besides, I didn't want to be away from the city this summer. I didn't know why, but I knew I had to be here. Jelly's Last Jam was settling in for a long run, and there was sure to be a national tour. All I needed was one chance to go on, sing, and hit my marks, and the rest would be history. Renee was bound to get bored. Maybe I would talk to the director about a role as one of the honeys. Part of the female Greek chorus, very important to the show. I walked into JR's and saw that the popular bar was empty with the exception of Billy, the regular bartender. "Hi, Nicole. How's the show?" "The show is going great. Sold out every night. What can I get you?" "Give me a cranberry and orange juice," I said, lifting myself onto a stool at the end of the bar. While Billy was mixing up my favorite juices, I stepped down from the bar stool, went to the ladies' room to see how well my makeup was holding up. On the way back to my stool, I called and checked my messages. "Yes, Miss Springer, you have two messages. One from Sam, you got the part, and another one from Dr. Gessler saying, congratulations, and I love you, and wear the black dress." I hung up the phone and took a deep breath and then let out a loud squeal. I quickly dialed Sam's number to confirm her message. She said the director called right after my audition. Sam's voice was filled with excitement. She said she had never got a director to call back so soon after her client auditioned. I didn't tell her about Pierce's intervention. When I hung up from Samantha, I called Pierce's office, but his secretary told me he was with a patient. I dropped my remaining quarters in my purse and headed back to the bar. "Good news?" Billy questioned. "The best." "Great news," I said gleefully as I walked briskly to the stool, took a long sip of the drink, and grabbed my bag and headed out the door. I stopped long enough to ask Billy to put it on my tab or make Delaney pay for it when she showed up. "It's on me," Billy yelled as I walked out the door. As I headed toward 8th Avenue to hail a taxi, I was so happy that I was literally skipping. I would give my mother a call to share the good news and then prepare my farewell to the cast of Jellies. I knew my mother would be happy, but I could also count on her saying, "When are you gonna get in a show that lasts as long as that Dream Girl show?" Was there any way to satisfy my mother? No, your mother sounds like a real fucking bitch. There's no pleasing them. All right. Let me see. I might give y'all one more chapter. Let me check with my butler on something. All right, y'all want another chapter? Let me see. Oh. These, I am so behind on everybody. Okay. All right, let me get on down with it. If you want it, I'm gonna give it to you. Anyway. Oh, hey, Blue Jasmine. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Love, John said, you know, we never turn down another child. Listen. Wait a minute. Wing said, of course we do, since the butler is being generous tonight. Child, the butler ain't being generous with shit. I'm trying to find out how long it is before he gonna have to do his own thing around here, and I don't want to be in his way. You heard me? I'm trying to be respectful. Good to see you. Good to see you. Happy Taco Tuesday to you, child. All right. Chapter 7. The things you do for love. Jared not only got me up each and every morning to exercise, but he also got me to do something that I'd never envisioned doing in this life, bowling. We would meet Friday evenings after work at a bowling alley near Lenox Mall and then head to a restaurant called Mix in Buckhead or to the popular bar Mr. V's Peachtree for drinks. On this Friday, all the time we were bowling, Jared seemed preoccupied and in deep thought. So preoccupied that I came close to beating him, which would have been something of a miracle. I too was preoccupied, thinking about the dinner I would use to reveal my feelings and myself to Jared. After bowling, we decided against going to Mix or Mr. V's, but went to my condo instead. We were drinking a couple of Rolling Rocks when Jared walked quietly toward the sliding glass door that led to the patio looking out over North Buckhead. "What's on your mind, buddy?" I asked Jared. "You seem to be out there with the stars." "Oh, just something I've got to clear up," Jared answered. "Anything I can help with?" "Well, you know this guy from my old neighborhood is running against Congressman Thomas," Jared said. "I've only heard you mention it. He's not serious competition, is he?" "No, not really. There's just some information I know, and I can't decide whether or not to share it with the congressman," Jared lamented. "What kind of information?" "Well, Jimmy D is gay," Jared said, with a trace of disappointment in his voice. "Gay?" I repeated, trying not to change my facial expression. "Yeah, and a couple of guys working on the campaign found out about it and want to use it to get him to drop out of the race." "Well, how do you feel about that?" I asked. "That's the problem. I don't know how I feel," Jared said as he took a long gulp of his beer. I took a sip of my warm beer and saw the disturbed look on Jared's face. This was really a big concern for him. In the 2+ years that we had known each other, this was the first time the word gay had been uttered by either of us. I thought maybe now would be the perfect time to tell Jared, when he suddenly started to think out loud. "I mean, I don't have anything against a person if that's what they choose to be, and I really don't like to start throwing dirt in political races, especially since there are two black men against a white candidate. But he could split the black vote and force a runoff." "Choose," I thought. So Jared thought someone chose to be gay. Should I correct him or let him continue to voice his feelings? The expression in his eyes was hard to read. "How real a possibility is that?" I asked anxiously. "Well, you never know," Jared said. "I mean, Jimmy has been on the city council for years and people in the community love him. He's done a lot for them. I've heard some people, Even my mother say that Congressman Thomas has gotten too uppity since he's been to Washington. Shouldn't the people decide? Do you think it's right to use something like that? And how do you know for certain he's gay? I quizzed, playing devil's advocate. Yes, the people will decide, and trust me on being certain about Jimmy, Jared said. Well, I wasn't going to touch that. I mean, it could only be one thing. This guy had come on to Jared at some point. If he had made a pass, I wondered why Jared didn't share that with me. Maybe the pass had turned into something more. Jared leaned on the steel banister, swallowed the rest of his beer, and stared aimlessly. So, what's on the agenda for the rest of the weekend? Jared asked after a brief period of silence and obvious deep thought. Well, I'm going to church with Gillian. Oh, that should be fun. Didn't you say something about a special dinner? Yeah, but that can wait till later. I mean, it looks like you've got a lot on your mind, I said, Jared said. Let me give you a call tomorrow. You doing your big brother thing? Yeah, first thing in the morning. Give me a call and let me know what you want to do, Jared said as he grabbed his briefcase and gym bag and walked slowly toward the front door. Okay, buddy, don't think too hard about that situation. You'll make the right decision, I assured him. You think so? I know so. Okay, Jared said as he gave me a hug with his powerful arms. After Jared left, I got another beer from the refrigerator and walked back outside to the patio. I watched dusk descend with orange and purple streaks as the sun blended with the clouds. I tried to interpret my conversation with Jared and wondered if his current dilemma was caused by his disgust or his own insecurities. I was beginning to feel a strange sense of betrayal. I wanted to believe that, in Jared, I had the most difficult of all things in this world to find, a friend and lover in the true sense of the words, someone with whom I could share my deepest confidences and completely bare my soul just hours before it had all seemed possible. Now, with a single conversation, I was not so certain. I heard a knock at my door, and since my doorman hadn't buzzed me, I assumed that it was Jared. I quickly opened the door without even looking through the peephole and realized that it was Trey, the evening doorman. Got this package for you, Mr. Tyler, Trey said as he handed me a box wrapped in my mother's familiar brown paper. Thanks, Trey. Looks like a care package from home, I said as I reached in my pocket to retrieve a tip for Trey. Don't worry about it, Mr. Tyler, Trey said when he saw my hands come out of my pockets empty. I'll take care of you later on this evening, I said. No problem. I was right. It was a package from my mom. I ripped open the box, and from the escaping scent, I realized what it was. There, in a tin box, were my favorite chocolate chip Butterfinger cookies. Good googly moogly. I'm sorry, my mouth just got really wet. That sounds really horrible. Chocolate chip Butterfinger cookies that only my mother could make. There was a little note from Mom stating that she would love to hear from her number one son. I bit into one of the tasty cookies and headed for the phone to call home. Why he didn't put them in the oven for just a few minutes and let them get a little warm. Good googly moogly. Anyway. Friday evening was the one night Mom didn't cook and demanded that, like it or not, Pop take her and Kirby to dinner. I looked at my watch and was certain they wouldn't be there, but I could leave a nice message. Much to my surprise, my mom picked up after two rings. What's going on, lady? I quizzed. Ray Ray, my mother said with a slightly startled voice. Who else? How you doing, baby? I'm doing great now that I have my care package cookies, I said, as I took a bite from my second cookie. Oh, you got them already. That was quick, Mama said. Yeah, how is everybody, and why aren't you out on your Friday night date, I asked. I'm here waiting on your father now. He's out looking for Kirby. How are Pops and Knucklehead, I asked. Oh, your father's fine, but your little brother? Well, that's another story, my mother said, concern in her voice. What's wrong with Kirby? Too long a story to go into right now, baby, but I will tell you this. Your father is thinking about shipping his lanky butt off to military school very soon, Mama said. No shitting, I replied. You'd better watch your language, mister, my mother laughed. I might have to tell your father to send you too. Is there anything I can do? Do you want me to talk with Kirby? I don't know right now. Let's see what Ray Sr. can do. Mom went on to explain that Kirby was staying out past his curfew and hanging out with a bad group at school. She said his grades were dropping and all he had on his mind were girls, basketball, rap music, and pressuring her to allow him to get a hole in his ear. She told me that Kirby's peers constantly kidded him about making good grades and being from a rich family. A rich family, My mother laughed. If these children only knew how hard we struggled to get here. But you're a school teacher, Mrs. Tyler. You've got to be rich, I joked. We talked about how kids had changed since I was a youth growing up in Birmingham and how there was even talk of LA type gangs moving into our hometown. I assured my mother that Pops would take care of it, and if she wanted me to, I would allow Kirby to come to Atlanta for an extended visit this summer. She said she would talk with Pops about it and give me a call next week. My mother also assured me that Pops, as always, had everything under control when it came to Kirby. After hanging up, I started to undress, put on a Whitney Houston CD, and debated how to spend the rest of the evening and my weekend. I thought about my conversation with Jared and tried to decipher his concerns. There he was, on one hand, condemning the gay lifestyle and subtly flirting with me on the other. I mean, he was sending out mixed signals, but so was I. I had to come face to face with the looming possibility that my friendship with Jared would not lead to romantic love. I also thought about my little brother and how he was growing up so fast. Since I didn't really have a social life, I thought it might be good to have him here with me. Thinking about that made me realize that the day when I would have to share my sexuality with my little brother was close at hand. I knew he was growing up fast and that I would have to sit down with him soon. But I was gonna clear with my parents first. Shit, you know your daddy may not let you do that. Child, shit. I took a long hot shower and sat nude in the darkness of my living room. Ew, I hope you sat on a towel, dude. Sipping a warm, stale beer on the sofa as the sounds of pre-summer played a haunting symphony outside my sliding glass door, and a soulful female voice floated throughout my condo. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. So Anthony said, military school, the answer to the problem, Chopper. Child, listen. No, and what it is really the beginning of a whole new set of fuckery for your child. You send your child off to military school, they do one of two, well, one of th well, they do quite a few things. It's a whole list of shit they could get assaulted. They could assault somebody, and I'm not just talking about sexual. I'm talking about physical assault. They get screamed at all the time. They get all kinds of, just listen, military school is not the fucking answer that black folks seem to think it is for black problem children. If you had started off disciplining your child correctly when they were young, they'd be so fucking scared of you, they wouldn't do anything wrong. And if they did do it, they'd make sure they do it way on the west side of Chicago and not all the way out in the suburbs. You wouldn't even know until they were good and grown, married with a child of their own, and then they'd bust out and tell you, listen, I was a gang member. And then you could be surprised about that because you hid the whole damn thing from your parents and they had no clue. Shit, listen, I'm trying to tell you what I know because I live that shit. My parents had no clue the foolery I was involved in. No fucking clue at all. You can do it too. You don't have to send your children off to military school. They be getting beat up and getting their heads put in toilets and all types of shit. They may get sexually assaulted, physically assaulted, have all manner of things. They get verbally assaulted. It's just a horrible fucking thing to have happen. And some of these children end up dead. Did y'all know that? There was a military school. I forgot where it was, but you can look it up because you know that Google is your friend. And they're also the owner of YouTube. Let nobody tell you different, okay? Anyway, you Google military school deaths and all this shit's going to pop up and you'll see a whole lot of those dead children were black children. Think I'm lying? Look it up. Listen, your children come back totally different from military school, and a whole lot of them come back fucked up, and quite a few of them don't even make it back, and they always make it the child's fault that they didn't come back. Child, you can go to hell with that shit. I knew what to do with my son. It was a number 12 cast iron skillet by Martha Stewart. The fear of that thing ringing his bell kept him in line. Do you hear me? Because I was going to ring his bell and see if anybody was at home in his cranium up there. I never had a problem. Right. Shit. You ring your kid's bell or threaten to ring it, I have to worry about it. So that's my story and I'm sticking to it. Wait a minute. Wing said. Raymond sat wet and naked on that plastic covered sofa and hope his sofa wasn't covered in plastic chocolate. Listen, you know how you sit on somebody's plastic sofa? Well, maybe it was just me when I was a kid, and then your thighs melted to that fucking thing. When you get up, you gotta scoot a little bit. It sounds like a huge fart. It's terrible. Stop having plastic ass couches in your home, grandparents. Anyway, yes, Anthony, I'm telling you, these military schools are terrible. They're not the answer, child. Discipline is the answer. Paying attention to your children, talking to your fucking children, instead of giving them tablets and fucking phones and remote controls to TVs and fucking video games. That's how you raise your goddamn child. Shit, you let some electronic device raise your child. I know you lying. Half of y'all don't even know who the fuck y'all kids hang out with. And I'm not saying y'all in here. I'm just saying y'all, the collective in the world. Shit. Y'all need to pay more attention to your children. You pay attention to your goddamn kids. You need to know who their friends are, what their parents do for a living, how their parents get down. That's what you need to know. That's how you can figure some shit out. I'm gonna tell you something. I forgot how old my son was. Who's back in Illinois? He was standing outside the fence. I'm standing in the kitchen washing dishes with the window up. I'm ear hustling the usual. He's standing in the fence. His friends are technically on the other side of the fence. My son gonna say, "Shit, I ain't scared of no other niggas. I'm scared of my fucking mama." That's because listen, I told my son, I can make you disappear and get away with it. Okay? I did my best. Like, my son didn't get like a whole lot of whoopings and all of that, but he knew when I connected with the fat part of his ass, I was playing no games. Discipline. Then it got to the point that he was placed on restriction. He was begging me to give him a spanking because restriction meant wasn't shit on in your room but the light. And that bitch was going off at 8 o'clock. How about that? You be laying in that fucker in the dark trying to figure it out. I don't give a damn. I played no games. I raised my damn son. I know you lying. Some of y'all folks are just watching your children age chronologically, hoping and praying they make it to 18 so you can kick them the fuck out the door and who knows what the hell gonna happen to them. So Anthony said, mine had a barber strap with holes punched in it. Yes, to grab the baby. That's what the babysitter had, affectionately known as my auntie. Yep, that's what it was, a barber strap, baby. Three licks needed. The first one dead in the muscles, second one the nerves, third one. That's how it felt, yo. I bullshit you not. That fucking thing. That fucking strap. And she would say, hey, Raymond, a strap. Oh my God, when it got your skin, it just right suck that shit, suck some of your meat right up in them holes, child. You described it perfectly, Anthony. Listen, I think it was only legal to give a child three licks with them fucking things. And then when you regain consciousness, they'd be like, see, I told you she was going to be all right. Oh, my God. You want to... Oh, my God. I cannot tell you how many times I got my ass tore out the frame by that damn strap. I didn't follow directions very well. Cause and most of the directions was, don't say shit else, Saki. Shut up, girl. Shit, I'm gonna have the last word. Old habits die hard. Stay out my goddamn business, child. Listen, let me get out of here, y'all. It's about that time. It's 9:59, and this was fun. Oh, Lord have mercy. I love y'all. This is this was much needed, child. I needed to end my night with this laugh. I'm trying to tell you, honey. Y'all be surprised. Listen. She said, I'm glad I wasn't raised. Child, listen. Listen, being raised taught you a set of rules that was very, very weird for most folks to deal with. You know, it was rules that you, a lot of people you expect would have it, but they don't. Oh, Lord have mercy. Let me get out of here because I'm gonna start another conversation. Like I said, I love y'all. Okay, this is fun. I thank y'all for being here with me. Uh-oh, Anthony done said something. Uh-oh. Well, you say magically they disappeared. I think they went to the closet and prayed. Lord, I hope I didn't kill my child. Right. Okay. Yes. Oh, you are welcome, Wings. And thank you for being here. Thank all of y'all for being here. And listen, I love y'all. Y'all be careful as y'all travel the highways and byways of the YouTube verse. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Thank you to my moderators for keeping us safe. And until next time, bye, y'all. Now the music done ended and y'all still here. Go to bed, sippers and speakers. Go to bed. Bye, y'all.